to turn it into kind of a space monster. And IPython is kind of like that. It's this thing that started really, really simple and has grown all these complicated moving parts. But we think it's for good reasons. What other things can you do with this kind of advanced display capabilities? We have a YouTube object. So you want to put into your slides a YouTube video, and you simply say YouTube video, and you give it the little identifier for the video, and there it is. Every video on YouTube has one of these little signatures, which is a random-looking string of about 10, 12 characters. And so you pass it that, and we will embed the actual YouTube video in there. You can actually change there. You can pass parameters to this function to change the size of the window if you want. And so the three videos that I put in here, along with this link, are actually a three-hour in-depth tutorial on advanced aspects of IPython. So effectively, what I'm teaching you to do is a very quick and short version of this, but I'm using it in a somewhat recursive fashion to link to the full version of that tutorial, which you can download all of the notebooks and all the teaching materials, and you can actually watch the entire video. This was recorded just a couple of months ago in Austin, Texas, at the annual SciPy conference. So here are all the three parts. I have a flash block thing on my computer, so flash pages don't, until I click on them, don't load. But this is what you, unless you have a blocker, this is what you would get automatically when you run. And any of you who has downloaded this, as long as you're on the network, you should be able to get this. So a few useful pieces of IPython for kind of everyday development work. You've already seen how when you ask question mark, you get this information from any object. We've seen that over and over again. We also have a couple of magics that if you just want specifically, for example, the doc string, you can say pdoc, and you will get automatically the doc string. So if you don't want to see the whole information, but you just want the doc string for an object, you can say pdoc, and that'll print it. If you say psource, you will get the source code for the object immediately, if we can find it. So things that the question mark kind of wraps, sometimes you just want to see one of those pieces. And you can get it. So these are sort of useful things to remember while you're using it. Another important aspect of IPython that can actually come in handy in many circumstances, that by now you've begun to see that there's kind of a model here where you have something happening in the browser, and that is connecting to something that must be happening somewhere else where you started it, and that's where the code must be executing, right? Well, it turns out that model of having what we call a kernel here running your code and what we call a client here, which is the web browser talking to it, is a model that you have access to. So if you type %connect info, this will give you the information about how that connection is happening. It prints a lot of data, but it's data that is very useful for certain advanced users. You actually want all of this data. But in particular, it tells you if you wanted to connect to the current kernel from any other IPython compliant tool, all you have to do is either paste this into a file and use it, and this file has the IP address and the port and the security key to make that connection, or if you want to connect just on the same computer, you can actually simply do this. You can say connect to an existing kernel and just paste that information. So let me show you. Where's my? I got a terminal with a light background color for presentation. Let me move it up here so the people in the back can see well. So we have other clients, and for example, we have a console client that runs at the terminal. Let me make sure that we get the colors right, because my default colors are for black terminals. And if I paste that I just copied from here, look at here I had prompt number 9. Let me, for example, create a variable here. A is equal hello bootcampers. Okay, I just made a hello bootcampers, and this was input number 10. And let me show you what happens when I connect to that. Oh yeah, when we get the very first prompt, we don't have the data yet, so we have to guess. And so the very first one that comes out can come as one. But look, once I actually execute and connect to the kernel, you see that A is hello bootcampers, and it says that this was computation number 11. I can say A is equal hi here. Whoops, A is hi, and then if I go back here and I print A, it's now hi. It shows me that these two are actually talking to the same process. And that can come in very, very handy. You may, for example, want to not to be doing lightweight experiments over here that are not saved into the notebook. I very often do that. I'll have a notebook and I have a terminal here. And so I do the quick and dirty checks on the terminal, but with the same data, right? You're talking to the same kernel, so with the same data. And I'd leave what I want permanently recorded in the notebook. Another reason why this can be handy is because the percent debug, for some of you, if you don't have IPython 1.0, percent debug doesn't work in the notebook because the older version didn't have that support yet. But here, it always works at the terminal. So you can always connect with the terminal and do percent debug. If you're talking to a remote server where you don't have a notebook installed, you can use this. If you're doing parallel computing, as we'll see, you can have N nodes running, and you can connect to any one of them with this machinery. So it's a more advanced part of the model, but it's very useful to be able to know that you can actually talk to these pieces of the architecture directly whenever you need them. And if I quit this, I can restart it again later, and it'll be there, and I can quit this, and I haven't killed the process because the process is controlled by the notebook over here. Okay? So we also have, just like we have the terminal console, we have a graphical console called the Qt console, and in fact, there's a magic that basically will do all the wiring for you. So if I type Qt console here, this will take a second to spin up. Oh, it already did. It didn't take that long. And here I have this graphical console that, and the nice thing about, if you don't have Qt installed, this wouldn't work for you, but the nice thing about the Qt console is that we can actually do all of the wiring. So all you have to do is type Qt console, and we'll do the whole connection info, find what the right flags are, all of that for you, and it'll just open up right there. So another aspect of this ability of IPython to talk to local and remote resources is its ability to grab files from anywhere. So imagine that you are trying to learn how to do a plot and you have some piece of data, and let's hope the network collaborates for just once. Maybe not. Okay. So often what I do when I want to do a plot, my standard MO is simply to That worked. Well, that's probably not going to work, which means that the later part of the demo that I wanted to do in the cloud isn't going to work either, because our lovely network can't really hold a connection very long. What you can do, let's imagine that you went to the matplotlib gallery and you found, I had the gallery open here. So let's imagine that you went to the matplotlib gallery and you found one of these figures is roughly what you want to run. And if you click on any one of these thumbnails in the gallery, what will happen is it will take you to a page that has, obviously here it's not going to work, but if the network was working, it will take you to a page that allows you to see the source code for that example. And it's a very useful thing to do, to just basically run that. And obviously, you could copy and paste it. In IPython, all you have to do is type percent load and give it. You can actually give it the address to the example. And it will go fetch the data, put it right here, and then you can run it locally. I can't demo it because the network isn't working. But I'm going to try to disconnect to see if, at least for later, the network behaves. No, in this case, it's just loading the Python. It's just loading, I'm giving it just the address to the PY file, and it'll just fetch the source file. All of these examples in the matplotlib gallery have a web page with the figure, the code, but they have a link to the raw script. And that's the link that I pasted. That's what I wanted to show you guys, but obviously I can't. Maybe I'll be able to get a connection once I try again. We'll see. Yes, question. Yes, anywhere, either local or remote. So what you can put here is either a local path on the file system. Let's see if this, maybe now I got a connection. Oh, no, great. Okay, the network's worthless. Maybe So what you can put in, you can pass to the load command either a remote URL from any website on the internet as long as it's publicly visible, or a local path. So you can also load a local script into the notebook right there just by passing it a local path. And it'll do the right thing. Load will basically say, is it local? It uses local mechanism. Does that look like a remote URL? It uses URL libraries to go fetch it, copy it, and bring it to you. Okay? Any other questions? All right. So another aspect of IPython which is interesting, and I don't expect many of you won't be able to run this part, so just watch me. And the reason is because it has additional dependencies, but I want you to know that this exists, and we can help you later install the necessary dependencies if this is of interest to you. Let's imagine that you're a person who actually likes Python, but for some reason you need to use R as part of your work, and you would like to mix a little bit of R in your work. So we have an extension called the R magic that allows you to imagine that you have X and Y, two variables that are in Python. These are two Python arrays, but you'd like to use some of the R linear modeling facility to basically to estimate the linear model of Y as a function of X, do some plotting using the R plotting facilities, and then compute the fit coefficients in R and get the fit back in Python so that you can keep working in Python. Something as simple as a linear fit, you can do it in Python too, obviously. But R has lots of really good useful libraries. How do you do that? This is all you need to do. You say %% R, and you say, I want as inputs X and Y, which are Python variables. And when you're done, I want to have the variable XY coef back as an output, back in Python. Do whatever you need in R, run the code for me, and then give me XY coef back. And so this has executed. These are, for those of you who are familiar with R, this is what a linear model summary looks like. It computes all these summary statistics. This is what the plot of a linear model estimator looks like in R. And then when I grab the XY coef variable, it's a standard Python variable that I have, and I can keep working with it. Yes, question. Yes, you're going to have to do, syntactically it won't look as clean. You'll have to use, because in a script there's no notion of cell boundaries, right? And we're taking advantage of the notion that there's this cell boundary right there that lets us know where the block finishes, and that doesn't exist in a script. So you'd have to wrap this into a string and do the %% R with the equivalent Python call. But we have a way of calling magics. It's called ipython.magic. So you would say magic %% R, blah, 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 and you would pass the block just into a triple quoted string.
If we were to use the export as script function,
we don't know. With the export as script, we don't handle multi-block magics correctly yet.
I have a network for you.
Oh, okay.
We're going to do a little network action. So maybe let's pull up.
No, I think it was the other way around.
You do it.
Cool. Make it an official font on GitHub so that we can actually style a whole notebook in XKCD style, and you can make an entire notebook look like it was hand-drawn, both the text and the figures. So Randall Monroe actually joined us yesterday on GitHub to start working on this, which is pretty cool. Anyway, so similarly to R, if you have code that you want to run in Octave, Octave is effectively a free clone of MATLAB. And if you have MATLAB code that you'd like to run, all you have to do is you load the Octave extension, and then you can say Octave, these are flags for what the figure size that you want, and then you just paste in Octave code right there, and it executes in Octave, and it gets the figures back and plots them. So it lets you mix and match, and you see I haven't restarted the kernel, I haven't changed anything. This same kernel has Python code, Octave code, R code. We also have an extension to access Cython. Cython is a technology that we've mentioned briefly a few times, which I actually need to keep track of my time, lets you effectively annotate Python code with small pieces of information about the type structure of the code, and it'll take that syntax that looks sort of 95%, it will turn it into pure C, which often can execute much, much faster than the original Python. So let's consider, for example, this very, very simple function, which is trying to do a really straightforward numerical integration of the function x squared minus x. So it takes that function and integrates it between two given points with however many divisions you want, okay? So this is a really simple Python integration. And let's imagine that I wanted to make this faster. How would I do that in Python? Once I have loaded the Cython extension, just like I said %R, I can say here %Cython. And now this block will be considered to be Cython syntax, not Python syntax. And the difference is, look, compare these two blocks. They're nearly identical code-wise. The only difference is that I have changed, instead of simply saying X, I say double X. I tell the compiler, you know what, this is always going to be a double precision floating point number. So you can forget about all the Python stuff. You can treat it as a pure number, and you can go much faster. And instead of def, I will say cdef, which means this function will never be called from Python, just from the C level, so you can make it as fast as you can. And similarly, the integration routine, if you look at the logic here, it's copied verbatim from above. The only thing I added was type information. I told it that I was an integer, and that S and DX were double precision numbers. And then I told it that A and B were doubles, and N was an integer. So the only thing I did was add information about types. I didn't actually change the code or the algorithm in any way. And if I run this, I didn't run that. So if I load it, now let's have a look at the timing comparison between the two versions. The pure Python version takes about 3 milliseconds to run, and the Cython version takes about 40 microseconds to run. So that's a factor of, I don't know what, like 70 or so speed up. So it's a really significant speed up. A factor of 70 is nothing to sneeze at, right? That's the difference between something running in a few minutes and taking a couple of days to run, like a half hour to several days. So between a lunch break and having to wait for 2 days for your results, with a minimal amount of changes. And Cython is a really powerful tool. We don't have time to cover it in depth here, but what we've tried to do is make it very accessible here. If you change the code here, it'll immediately recompile it for you. And we're actually calling a fairly complex amount of low-level machinery for you to make this more straightforward. Another example of something that you can do, call Ruby. If you have Ruby installed on your system, you put %Ruby, and then you can execute a block of Ruby. We showed you Bash yesterday. There's a similar one for Perl, et cetera, et cetera. So we show you how you can integrate sort of lots of other pieces of technology into your everyday workflow as part of your research activity. Okay? Are there any questions with this part of what I've showed you? We're going to switch gears into some examples on parallel computing. No? Okay. So now let me go to the second notebook. Let me get some space here, and let me remove all output. So it turns out in Python you can do parallel computing, and this is a really complex topic, so we're only going to see a very, very brief introduction to this. We have extensive documentation on this and an entire different in-depth tutorial, which is by itself 3 full hours on this, and it actually sort of just scratches the surface. Parallel computing is a complex topic. I mean, normally you take that as a full, like a semester-long graduate course, typically. And the IPython machinery doesn't try to replace existing tools for parallel computing, it tries to complement them. So there was a question yesterday from one of you in the audience about computational fluid dynamics, and one of the answers was you probably need to look into tools like MPI. Those are the classic workhorse of the high-performance community, computing community, for tightly coupled, typically spatial domain decomposition or time domain decomposition problems that need lots of internal communication. IPython doesn't compete with a tool like MPI. What it does is it complements a tool like MPI. It actually integrates with MPI, and it lets you do certain things that MPI makes difficult and awkward. So you can do certain, the parts that MPI is very good for, you can do them in MPI, and other parts of high level control and interactivity and exploration, you can do those with the IPython machinery. If you don't need MPI, that's fine. The examples that I'm gonna show today have nothing to do with MPI, that's a bit too advanced for today. But I just wanna mention that if you are in the category of people who does those kinds of problems, you may still actually benefit from these tools. And our documentation has examples of that. So how do I use the IPython parallel machinery? Well, we've tried to make it really easy for you. If you go to the dashboard, over here, this is the part of the dashboard that lists your notebooks, but there's a second tab called clusters. And what it does is it lets you start and stop what we call an IPython cluster. So when you're running a notebook, you have an engine connected to in the back, this kernel that executes your code. When you start an IPython cluster, you actually start more of those. But now those are available. They don't have a single notebook connected to each one of them. They're just sitting there as a resource. So the idea is you spin up this resource, and now you can work with it, and you can use it to do your computations and spread them out. And that resource can be, in this case, I've started two engines in my laptop. This is a dual-core laptop, so I've started just two engines. But it could be many more, and I'm going to show you in a minute how to do this in the net on the internet in parallel, okay? If I can get the network to behave nicely. So once I have started my cluster, how do I actually use it? I load my standard numerical routines, just like always, the matplotlib. I've made a small change to the figure size, and this is the code that I run. I import from the IPython parallel module something called the client. And the client is this thing that basically represents my cluster, okay? It's an indirect handle on my whole cluster. And then I make an instance of it. Client is a class. I make an instance that connects to it. If you're working locally, this is all you need to say. If you're working remotely, I may need to change this line to specify a different communication protocol. I will mention what that means when we get to working in the cloud. And then once I have that client, that proxy, then I make instances of my engines. I grab pieces of my engines to actually give them code to execute. So I can say, give them all to me. This is the client object behaves like a list of engines, and then I can say, give me all of my engines because I'm going to run code on them. Or you may say, I need the even ones for a certain thing and the odd ones for something else. Or I need just four for this part and the remainder for something else. In this case, I'm going to say, give them all to me. And when I execute this, it says, my cluster has two nodes. Nnode is a variable that I made. It's just the length of my cluster. So we detected that I have two nodes. And the way this operates, and as I said, this is a brief introduction just to show you what can be done, because this is, as I said, a topic that we can't do justice to in just an hour. The cluster object lets you apply call functions on the remote engines. So you've already seen how a small function is written, a local function lambda simply. This is simply a function that returns the string hello world. If I say apply synchronously, it will call that function on each node. So if I call that function locally, I would get hello world. If I call it on my cluster, I get a list of hello world. That function is executed in each one of my nodes. I can also call apply in what's called an asynchronous mode. An asynchronous mode is a mode where the code returns immediately, and then you can continue working. And then you only get the result when you call get. Why is this useful? Because you may want to say, all of my nodes start doing some work. In the meantime, I continue doing some other things here. And then when I actually need that data, I can do get, and then it will actually wait for the data to arrive, and then you can continue working with it. So whenever you're doing parallel computing, it does get complicated because you basically have to start thinking as you break down your problem in who and when is the work going to get done, and is it to your advantage to maybe start something over here and keep working here so that more computation can happen in the same total amount of time, okay?
Just trying to get better network connection.
Okay. So similarly to apply, which calls one function, the cluster has map functions, and it has both map sync and map async. And what the map function does is, just like the local map version, let me show you what, if I say, map, if I say map with the Python map function, this is what I will get, right? Map is a Python built-in that takes a function and applies it to all the elements of a list. So the cluster can do the exact same thing. It takes a function, the syntaxes are completely identical, but it does it remotely and then fetches the results back out, right? And PX can be used as a line magic. Remember we discussed single percents are line magics. They apply just to the rest of the line. And double percents are called cell magics. They apply to the whole block. So if I say double percent PX, it means the whole block of code is not going to run on this notebook. It's going to run in my cluster. So when I execute this, what I did was in each node, I said import the OS module and get me the process ID of each node. This is to show you that, let me, by the way, do that on this node. So this is getting the process ID of my kernel, and these are the process IDs of my nodes. And as you can see, they have different numbers. This shows you that there really are three separate processes, right? My kernel is processed 2723 in this case, and each of my two cluster nodes has a different number, and they have them in sequence because they get started together, so they typically get numbers that are in sequence. They don't have to be in perfect sequence, but they typically get numbers in sequence. So this is a really lightweight and quick introduction to the main concepts. You basically have code. You can send it to apply on one of them or to scatter it to all, and the basic two modes of executing code are either synchronously or asynchronously. What kinds of things can you do besides printing hello world 100 times, which isn't super interesting? Well, let's consider a very, very simple but realistic problem, which is estimating an integral numerically. In this case, we're going to compute pi. By computing the area of a circle is pi r squared, right? So if you compute the area of a circle of radius 1, that area is the number pi. Let's imagine that you wanted to estimate pi numerically. Well, you can do so by the simplest method for numerical integrals that where you don't want to use anything about the analytic structure of the function is to do a Monte Carlo, what's called a Monte Carlo integration, where the idea is, imagine that the area that you want to compute, and because of the symmetry of the circle, we can do it just on a 1/4 of the circle, and then we multiply the answer by 4. Imagine you have this square right here, and you were throwing darts. You grab random points on the square, right, and you simply throw darts, and then you count which darts landed inside the circle and which darts landed outside the circle. Well, the fraction of those, since you know the area of the square, the area of a square of radius 1 is 1, since you know the area of the square, if you threw infinitely many points that covered the square uniformly, that ratio would be the area of the little part in the circle. Obviously, if you only throw 10, it's going to be a poor estimate, but the more you throw, the more darts you throw, as long as they're uniformly distributed, the better your estimate of this will be. So this is a really stupid way of computing a one-dimensional integral where there are many better methods, but if you're trying to compute numerically a very high-dimensional integral where you have no knowledge whatsoever of the analytical structure of the function, there are a few things you can do beyond this kind of stuff. Because if you really have no knowledge whatsoever of the structure of the function, the best you can do is basically randomly sample it. And so here's a simple implementation of sampling the circle and computing. So, and I've written it deliberately, really, really simply. I say I want to sample the circle n times. I print however many it is. I have a counter, and I do a loop. And every time I get a random XY pair, and I compute the radius of that. And if that radius is less than 1, I count it. If it isn't, I don't count it. That's it. That's the entire implementation. The brute force pi is just sample the circle, take the ratio and multiply by 4 because we did the counting in 1/4 of the square, okay? That's it. This is the entire Monte Carlo numerical integral for the circle. How do I do that in the cluster? Well, it's basically the same thing except that instead of calling sample circle here, I'm going to call sample circle on my cluster, so I called map, right? And instead of calling it with n, I call it with n over the number of nodes, but I call it on a list of the number of nodes, right? So instead of saying I want to execute on each node, say a million times, I divide a million by however many nodes I have, and that's how many times I execute on each node, and then I gather the results, because now I'm going to get, each node is going to count a chunk of them, and then I just add them back together. That's it. So the change from the local version to the remote version is really very, very straightforward. Just divide the work, send it, and get it back. And here I wrote a little error function to do compare with the analytical value so we can get an idea of what the errors look like. And now I can, if I want, so I'm going to show you two ways of computing this. We can use the cluster version, or we can use the magics to execute the code directly as if we had typed it in the cluster. So if I want that, I can, obviously I could do double percent PX and repaste the cell, but you don't want to be pasting the cell twice to have it here and there. What you can do is you can say, cluster. Send these functions over there so I can also call them in my cluster. So the push method of the cluster simply says send these functions over to the cluster. And now let's say that we want to sample this a million times. The brute force estimation takes, I'm running it on my laptop, it's going to take, I think, about 12 seconds with this machine with a million points. That's what it took a little earlier today. Yep, about 12 seconds, and I get an error a little bit under 1%. Now, I want to call the same exact code that I called here, but I want to call it on the remote nodes. So n, in that case, I want it to be n over n naught. So I can say on my cluster, the variable n is actually on each node. It should be n over the number of nodes. And then I run this with px. And if you see, because this is full IPython, you can still put magics in the nodes. And now look at what happened. Each node only took 4 seconds. Though the local, and I run it on 2 nodes, and I got the exact same. And now let's have a look at, now I have to add the results and take their mean. And so I got a comparable answer. And one node took 12 seconds, 2 nodes took a total of 4 seconds. Why? This is better than linear improvement. This is not supposed to happen. In parallel computing, you typically get, at best, sublinear improvement. This is a somewhat counterintuitive result. What's happening here are memory effects. This actually took me by surprise, and it doesn't happen at all sizes. If I make a smaller sampling, it's actually just about a factor of 2. But at a certain size, I was getting better than a factor of 2. And what's happening are memory effects in the CPU are such that with the full million long sample puts so much memory pressure on a single process that cache effects slow you down, whereas apparently, and I am ad-libbing here a little bit. I'm not exactly sure what's going on, but I believe there are memory and cache effects that are actually making the fragmented version perform super linearly in terms of improvements, which is rather unusual. Okay? So this is by calling it. And now I can also call the cluster version, which I simply call locally without the double percent px. I simply call the cluster version. It runs here. And again, it behaves the same. So you have 2 ways of doing it, right? You can either implement it as a local function that sends the work to the cluster, or you can do basically whatever you were running locally, you do double px and it runs remotely. Sometimes one or the other is a little bit more friendly to development and debugging, et cetera. So what did we do? What did we do? Yes, you have a question. Yes. So the question was for those in the other room or watching online, where is the cluster? So the cluster is in the same machine. How? Let's try to find out where the cluster is. So one, if I type hostname, this gives me the hostname of my computer. Okay, and my computer is called Alpamayo, which is one of the most beautiful peaks in Peru that I haven't climbed. And let's see what happens if I. So my local hostname is Alpamayo, and if I run the hostname command on all of my nodes, so this shows you how convenient having these magics is, because I can just put double percent px and execute that same command on all my nodes, it also reports Alpamayo. All my engines are running on my cluster. That's because I started my cluster here, and by default, it just spins more processes on the same computer. But you can actually define these configurations so that when you click start, it submits a job to start your cluster, for example, in a supercomputer. And we've done that. It takes a little bit of work to define the configuration to do that, but we have done work where people can actually right from their laptop type start, click on start, and it'll spin up 500 nodes on an IRC supercomputer, for example, on a classified machine. And when they're all up and running, you connect from the laptop, you run your job, and you fetch the data for visualization and plotting on your laptop. But in this case, these two guys happen to be running right here on my notebook. Does that answer your question? Okay. So, all I did here was actually, in order to give you a quick visualization, I'm not going to spend too much time on it. What I did was slightly modify the code, not only to run the sum as before, but actually to keep the list of points as a NumPy array and get it back, because I want to show you the sampling. So I don't want to go into the details. You can compare the two codes. It's basically doing the same thing, but instead of doing a loop 1 point at a time, I'm making the whole array and saving the array, and I'm sending the arrays back. Because what I want to show you is, this is what the sampling looks like, right? So this is the sampling on one node. This is the actual sampling. If I run this again, look, if I rerun it and I plot again, the distribution of the points changes a little bit because each time I run it, I'm generating a new random sampling of the square, in this case with 1,000 points. And what happens if I do a cluster version of this one? And as I said, I don't want to get into the details. Look, now I'm getting the list of points from each node, but I'm plotting each list of points in a different color, right? And you see how each of the nodes is actually sampling differently. This kind of thing is really important to check when you're doing parallel computing. If you make a mistake, you could end up just repeating the exact same computation in all the nodes. If all of the points lined up on top of one another, I wouldn't be getting any statistical improvement by doing, I would just do this to meet that demand. Well, what do they do with those computers the rest of the year? They decided, let's rent them out and see if anybody wants to rent them out. And so they stumbled kind of by accident on a huge gold mine that now everyone and their mother is competing with. So now Google has something equivalent and Microsoft has something equivalent. This idea of effectively renting compute power on demand, and they call it Amazon Elastic Cloud. The idea is there's computers in their data centers and you can connect to them and you can grow or shrink how many you use on demand, and they charge you a price and they have a price table. And that price table actually has different models. If you want them right now, they have a fixed price, but you can actually bid. And if you're willing to wait, like I want some of them today, but they don't have to be right now, the prices go lower, or you can bid at a fixed price rate and then they'll become available when demand is so low that they hit that price point. So it's a very elaborate model, and it has had a significant enough impact that when their data centers go down, pieces of the internet go dark, like Netflix stops working, or GitHub, GitHub is not on Amazon, I think. But big pieces of the internet actually go down when Amazon services go down, because many of the companies that you know about from San Francisco and Silicon Valley and the big startups of today actually run all of their stuff on Amazon. That's how three people in their garage can run a startup that has supposedly a bunch of servers. They don't. They're just running there. And what we're going to do is we're going to use, if the network cooperates, we're going to use something called StarCluster, which is a project from MIT that is a gorgeous project to manage Amazon clusters and spin them up for you with everything ready for work with IPython and the notebook and parallel computing and everything. So I don't have time to go through all the details of the configuration of this. This would be for the course. But I have already started my cluster. It took me about 3 minutes to spin up. Well, this was restarting it. It takes about 10 minutes to spin up the cluster. And what I did was I started a cluster on Amazon, and that cluster is running at this web address. It's already up and running for me. It says that the security certificate is self-generated. It gives me a warning, but there it is. If you look now, the address at the top, that's not 127.0.0.1 anymore. That's a long-looking Amazon AWS.com address. That's Amazon Web Services, right? And now I'm in the cluster, and it's an empty cluster that just spun up. I told the configuration system to give me 11 nodes. This gives me a cluster with 11 machines, the head node where I log into the notebook, and 10 for the cluster. And they do everything. Star cluster does everything. It starts them up. This is what... when it starts, it prints a bunch of stuff for a few minutes about configuring and creating cluster and blah, 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 blah. And when it's done, it says, here, click here. This is the URL where it's running. And I gave it what password I wanted to use. And so now I can upload a notebook. So let me upload the notebook that I just showed you running on my laptop, okay? So we just ran that notebook in my laptop, right? And now I've uploaded it into Amazon, and I'm going to start running it in Amazon. The connection, we'll see how it behaves. So now let me run. And look, the prompt changed back to 1 because I'm running the same notebook that I just ran, but now it's over there. And so it's prompt 1, blah, blah, blah. How many nodes? So here I got an error. Remember, I had said on Amazon I have to change one line of code. Instead of connecting just with client, I have to say, use the pickle packer. Basically, it's a low-level parameter where the default communication mechanism that you can use locally doesn't work on their network, so we just have to change one flag. That's the only change I have to make. And now it says my cluster has 10 nodes. I told it I want 11 machines. I get a head node plus 10 more. Now I can run, look, now hello world, I get 10 of them, etc. the process list gives me 10 processes, and we can run the exact same Monte Carlo code. So now let's have a look at more significant speedups. If I run on one on the head node on Amazon with a particular hardware that they gave me, I'm using the cheapest one, so I'm paying about 10 cents an hour per computer. So this is costing me about $1.10 per hour because I spun up 11 machines. It took about 13 seconds to run. They're basically roughly equivalent to this laptop. And now let's rerun the same code on the 10 nodes. Yeah, it took about a second. So the 13 and a half second time went down to 1.2 seconds. Let's run the one that uses that I can, so that I can time the whole run. Yeah, 1.24 seconds. Obviously, you have to wait for the slowest, and they don't exactly all run at the same speed, but we went from 13 seconds to 1.2 seconds. The host name here is master, is the name of the master host. Each of the nodes has an auto-generated node 01 through node 0010. This is what Amazon does for you automatically, well, what StarCluster does. And let's run the version that we can visualize, again, with 1,000 points. So now you see how each node is sampling 100 points out of the 1,000. For the visualization, I did 1,000,000 for the high accuracy estimate. For the viz, I did only 1,000 points because otherwise we'd clobber the screen. But here you see how each of the nodes is sampling a different part of the space. And we literally spun up the cluster, we uploaded the notebook, and I only had to make one change right here. I had to change from this line right here to this line. That's it. And then we're running on 10 machines. And when I'm done, so let's say, OK, we're done. Computation's over. Start cluster, terminate my cluster, and that'll kill it completely, and I stop paying. If I say stop, instead of terminate, I can say stop my cluster. It'll stop it, but sort of save it recorded. And then I pay much, much less, like just a few cents an hour, but it's faster to restart. If I say terminate, I kill it completely. And then when I start it again, it'll take a little longer, but I don't pay at all. Question?
Is this something that you ever make?
So the question is this something that you do in the terminal? Absolutely. You can run this exact same code can run completely from the terminal. You can run it in a script that you don't even connect interactively to. You can use all this code from a script. You can, using StarCluster, well, I haven't said yes, so yes, I want to terminate my cluster. If I want to SSH into the nodes, StarCluster makes it really simple, because instead of having to know all the addresses, it basically knows where they are. So instead of saying SSH and copy and pasting IP addresses, you say StarCluster SSH, and it puts you on the node right there, and you can open the terminal and start working at the terminal remotely. Yes. Does that answer your question? Yes, question.
So
we've worked pretty hard to make the APIs the nicest of all. So we're obviously biased because we spent a lot of time writing this code. But we think that the IPython APIs for parallel computing are some of the nicest ones in existence. And they have the advantage of cooperating very well with MPI, which is an advantage. But for example, it's important to know they don't replace MPI, right? So if you have a piece of a problem that needs to do extensive inter-node communication, that part of the problem should be done by MPI, because MPI is very efficient at that kind of very fast inter-node transfer, and there are really good Python bindings for MPI. MPI for Pi is a project that has very high-quality MPI bindings, so that you can write the MPI part of the code itself in Python, or you can wrap C or C++ or Fortran MPI codes. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm sorry, the question, I forgot to repeat it. The question was sort of where would I recommend the IPython parallel tools versus others? And as I said, I'm obviously biased. But this brings me back to, I killed my node. So now obviously this web server is completely dead. And if I click on anything here, it's not going to work because I completely killed the cluster. Here it hasn't finished killing it, but by now the nodes are gone and the server is about to go down. Okay, so one more thing that I wanted to show you is there is, yesterday there was a fellow in our industry panel, Ken Alcabani, from a Berkeley startup called PyCloud, who was here. And PyCloud is a company that offers an API that basically wraps the Amazon cloud management for you. And so you install a Python library called Cloud, and then instead of doing the IPython sort of start the cluster and connect to it with the little cluster object, you say import cloud, and you say cloud.map. So it actually looks, if you compare this cloud.map sample circle, you break down the thing, and then you do the sum, it's basically exactly what the API looks almost identical to. Let me copy them here so that you guys can, I should have put these next to each other so that it's easier. So this is the IPython version where you use the IPython cluster and you call map the function and you break it down. This is what the cloud one and then you do sum. Well, it kind of looks like that. You do cloud, map, the function, you break down the list. The only difference is that in here you get a job ID, and then to get the result you have to call result, and then you do the sum part. But they're basically very, very similar. Conceptually, they're very similar. The difference is that PyCloud basically wraps the management for you. So what you get is once your jobs are running, you get a little web portal where you can see the status of your jobs and whatnot. They offer some convenience around that, but they're basically reselling Amazon time. And so obviously there's a certain markup, and it's basically up to you. I personally don't use them. I just spin up my own clusters with Star Cluster and connect to them. But there are people who find that API convenient, and but part of what I'm trying to illustrate is that all conceptually they're very, very, very similar, right? You see that the code that you write in both cases is extremely similar. It'll be up to you to see whether you prefer that convenience or not. If you do it directly, you obviously have much finer grain control because you're running yourself on the nodes. You can have your own databases on the nodes. You have very fine grain control. Their API is much more high level. You can transfer certain kinds of data, and you have certain access to storage, but not as fine grained. You had a question. Did you have another question?
Well, kind of, but I based it. Can you use sum also?
I'm sorry? Well, in this case, it's just the sum of n numbers, so it's probably not worth it. But yes, if you have a sum of very many numbers, then yes, what you do is you do the reductions per node, and then you only do the aggregation. Typically, whenever you're doing parallel computing, you're typically thinking of what jobs can I chop up into sub-jobs, do that execution, and there's very often, at the end, there's always a reduce step. So this paradigm is roughly, I mean, this is a really simple version, but this is roughly what is called as a map reduce paradigm, which is you call map, which means you send something, it can be many different things depending on what problem you're solving, whereas reduce in Python has a very specific syntax and it does one very specific thing. Okay, so it doesn't exactly translate identically. Any other questions? Okay, so I think this is it time-wise, right? Is anybody keeping track of time for me? I can look at the schedule. Let me go look at the schedule. Okay, so we should probably then stop here because I know that people are getting tired. Do we have, what time does the next one start? Okay, so yeah, so we do have time. Yeah, because the third one is the one, I'm actually doing okay. So the third one is the one that has, let me close a bunch of these things. So the third one is the one on is the notebook on custom display logic, and this is the one that you can consider the breakout because it's the one that has exercises. I didn't want to try to give you exercises on parallel computing; it's a little too complicated for after 15 minutes of seeing it, trying to do some of that stuff, and debugging is a nightmare. But this notebook has this idea of using basically it builds on the object-oriented examples from yesterday, and what you have is an explanation of how to give your own objects your own way of representing themselves. And the solutions are right there. So what I want you to do is basically load this notebook and execute it and read a little bit of. So the idea is what we did was we added the concept that if your objects, in addition to having a double wrapper double underscore REPR double underscore like you saw yesterday with Josh, if they have single underscore wrapper HTML, then that can return HTML and will display it. If they have JSON, you can return JSON data. If they have JPEG, you can return an image data. And so here I show you a couple of examples. For example, how pandas can do either simple text representation of a data frame. This is a simple data frame from this little bit of data. Or if you say, I want the fancy representation to be turned on, then it will activate this method, and it'll give you, instead of this, you see this much nicer version, right? And so the first exercise is to actually try to write a simple circle class that doesn't have to do anything. You don't have to implement constructors. The only thing that we want you to implement is a method to do HTML representation, to do SVG, and to do LaTeX, but we're giving you there the actual values that you have to return. So you can copy and paste the values. All you have to do is implement these special methods, wrapper HTML, wrapper LaTeX, and wrapper, wrapper SVG. And so that we can see a circle, in HTML, in SVG, in LaTeX, and in JavaScript. Okay, and the solution is right there. And then the second part of the exercise is, how do I add this kind of thing to an object if I can't modify it? So here you're writing your own circle class, and you will write these methods. The second exercise is, it turns out you can add these things to existing libraries. So for example, in SymPy, by default, SymPy, which is the symbolic computing library, prints its expressions like this in just ASCII. But it turns out you can say, add fancy ASCII printing, or you can say, I want you to add fancy LaTeX printing. So the same expression can be presented in plain ASCII with Unicode, kind of like typewriter style, or it can be done in full mathematical LaTeX mode. And this is being added to the library. And here I show you, so this is probably the more advanced part of the exercise, but it's all explained there. How do you add special formatting methods if you can't modify an object? So in the first part, you're writing the object, the circle class, and you're adding these methods. But it turns out that you can add your own formatting machinery to existing objects. So if you have an object that you can't modify, but you would, because it comes from somebody else's code, but you would like to look at it more nicely in the notebook, then you can add what's called a display formatter. So you can say the display, for example, if I want this circle, if I create a class called circle, which simply its wrapper is just a string, but I would like to represent it instead as a I use matplotlib to plot it as a circle using matplotlib, then I can say, and I'm giving you here a function that makes a circle, then I can say, grab the PNG formatter, which is the thing that actually can grab any object when it shows up and represent it as PNG, and say, whenever I see another circle, call the PNG circle function. So now, when I see one of these things, instead of printing circle, it actually draws the circle. So what this lets you do is say, this is a library, I didn't touch the another circle class, it exists, I have no control over it, but when I see another circle, I want to see it drawn by matplotlib because it's more informative. Well, all I have to say is, for the PNG formatter, whenever you see an object of type another circle, call this instead. And that will happen automatically from this point onwards. And so what I want you to do is use that idea to add also a LaTeX formatter. And the solution is also there. So you have about 15, I think we have about 15 minutes before the next one, so that you guys can give it a try. If you don't get to the second one, at least try to get through the first one, which is basically just copy and paste from the explanation, okay? And people have used this to great success. As I showed you, Pandas, SymPy, many libraries have used this machinery to basically make their objects look rich and sophisticated when they're viewed in the notebook without losing any compatibility with the standard Python code, because this only shows up in the notebook. In the normal use of the library, you don't see any of that. Question?
Like on the screen right here, so if you have C, if you just type C, does IPython try to find the best?
Yeah, so the question is, if I just type C, what is it going to display? So the underlying machinery, what happens is we don't send a representation, we send a dict with all the representations, and each client has a priority list of what it considers to be, quote, the best. Now, you can always see one specifically. If you call these display methods, you're basically saying, show me the HTML, show me the PNG if you have one. Right, I want to see specifically LaTeX, I want to see, but if you just say C, each of our clients has a priority list. So for example, the notebook considers LaTeX, I think, is the highest priority, then HTML, then the images one. The Qt console, for example, doesn't know how to do LaTeX, so it does some of the others first. The terminal won't give you an error. It'll take the base one. So if you connect with a client, terminal client, and you say C, it's fine. It's not going to barf because it doesn't know how to display a figure. It'll just print the text version because that's what it can do. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, folks, give it a try for a few minutes. Ask us questions if you have any. And if you really get frustrated, just type percent load and you'll see the solution. I actually left the solutions in this case right there. Try not to cheat. Give it an honest effort. And then we'll move on to the next one. But I'm happy to answer questions or come over to see you if you need anything. And at 2:10, in about 10 minutes, we'll go over the solutions. The solution is actually really short, so we'll go over them at a little more like 2:13 or something. So there is a problem with the zip file that I'm going to fix, okay? But the individual notebooks, you shouldn't try to download this. What you do is, these are NBviewer links so that you can see them, so that you can view the notebooks. If you ever want to download a notebook from NBviewer, you just click here. It says download notebook. And that will save the notebook to your... The homework is the display logic one. That's the one that has... And you just click download notebook right there. Now, the zip archive is busted. Apparently, I did upload it, but I guess the network ate it halfway in flight. So that link is broken. I'm about to re-upload it to fix that. What the hell? I guess the way this thing works, I didn't know this. So I guess if you click on this, what happens, it's not completely busted. Man, I hate this Google Sites thing. I guess what it does, where did the... What, I guess what you get when you click on an archive is they give you like a page to download the individual components of the archive. This thing is weird.
Oh yeah, I gave you the Google Drive. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. When I try, and then when you right click on it, you get an HTML file, right? Which is strange. I'm trying to say that.
Okay, so let's see if that helps matters. Yeah, so this is what happens. When you click on archive, instead of letting you download the zip file, it gives you a view so that you can download files one at a time. Because obviously giving you the whole zip file would be way too convenient. They have to break it down for you. The whole point of making an archive was to give you all the files in one bundle, and they actually split it up and give you this page. And you have the luxury of clicking your way through 10 times. Because, oh no, they're showing you an archive, and they couldn't give you a single link to say download all. This? Ah, well, but that's not particularly obvious. So, okay, so here's the trick. When you're looking at this thing, if you hit Command S or Control S, it does save the zip file. Whether that's obvious to anyone, it's not obvious to me, but this is the new Google. Yay. Yeah, it's obvious to someone, not to me at all. Did you have a question?
Yeah, quick question. Yeah. So essentially, Python is just an open way to run exactly what you just did. But yeah. If you actually want to code up MPI commands in your routine, is that a separate library that you can import into Python?
Yeah, it's called MPI for Py.
Okay.
It's called MPI for Py. It's a set of bindings to it, underlying libMPI, open MPI.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And we have examples in our stuff of combining MPI and IPython. There are things that, for example, you can do all the low-level communication in MPI, but then at each time step of your simulation, send data.
Hold on, is this on?
Things that are really annoying to do in MPI, you can combine the two.
Just so people don't feel like they have to go and cheat, when you're implementing the wrapper methods, those are all single underscores. Those aren't double underscores. So some people in the other room are running into trouble trying to do like underscore, underscore init. They were trying to do underscore, underscore wrapper, but it should just be underscore wrapper, underscore HTML, underscore. Okay?
Thank you. So
there's
let's
like
start.
A lot of people freaking out.
Okay. I don't want to go over the schedule of over James's schedule. So 2:10. Okay, I'm going to give 2 more minutes and then I'll present the solution. Yeah, question. All right, folks, can we get the lights down so that we wrap up the solution and I don't eat into James's time? Oh. Got it? Okay. Are you guys good here with Mike and all that?
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. All right, so I'm going to explain quickly the solutions. And Josh, who actually really cares about our Berkeley student population, insisted that I remind you that we're done torturing and abusing you. This is the last breakout of the 3 days, so you can sort of breathe a sigh of relief and we won't subject you to any more of this. And the rest of the session is going to be mostly just like watching cool stuff happen on the screen and seeing the kinds of interesting things that people can, that you can do with this, but you can relax your brains. So let's load the solution here. The very first one, so here I'm using the little load, the file was right there on the disk. So all you had to do was basically copy and paste these values into the proper methods, wrapper HTML, wrapper SVG, wrapper LaTeX, and wrapper JavaScript. And each one of these returns data on in that format. So this is valid HTML, this is valid SVG, this is valid LaTeX, and this is valid JavaScript, a JavaScript command. And so once I defined an object of type MyCircle in this, let's see what happens when I say display HTML. I get a little dot. And look, it's set here in bold, bold HTML and bold in parentheses so that we could see, otherwise we'd see just a teeny little dot in there. If I say display SVG, we've created a circle using SVG syntax, a circle that's 100 pixels wide and tall, and with this center, with a black stroke of width 1 and filled in blue. In LaTeX, we get the big circ. LaTeX operator and the LaTeX command, which if you spell LaTeX with backslash that way, LaTeX renders it with the A and the E nicely offset. They've put that into LaTeX. And look at what happens with JavaScript. If you say alert, I am a circle. Oops, I need to do this. Oops. Oh, I haven't executed this one. If I run this, look, you actually pop up a window because JavaScript controls your browser. So you can actually, an object can have a representation which is code and which does dynamic things. And we are working in the fall exploiting this machinery extensively to allow you to couple back-end heavy-duty computational resources in Python to all of the fancy modern JavaScript libraries that do high-end visualization in JavaScript in the client. So if you come back next year to the boot camp, you will see all kinds of fancy, snazzy JavaScript visualization connected to back-end resources, including the Perl computing stuff. So we're kind of excited. That's the work that we're doing in the fall. Okay. And so the other one was fairly similar, but in this case, we had a class that had its own wrapper. Remember the another circle class whose wrapper is very straightforward, and we had our function to plot a PNG. So how do we add it? We simply, so if I call the display LaTeX, let me break now the cell here. Oops. If I simply call display LaTeX here, I say I don't get anything because that object doesn't have any LaTeX representation yet, so I don't get anything. But now what I get, when you download the full zip archive, these little two Python files are right there. So once you run the load cell, they'll show up. Oh, the question was how do I get to those solutions? And so there, and the zip archive have them. You don't need this. No, you have your own. Okay. I'm gonna figure out what went wrong there.
No, not again. Whoa, something happened. Some sort of a phase progression type thing.
Interesting.
Still spinning. Well, it seems to be working, so let's leave it.
All right, hello everyone. I'm James Gao. I'm a grad student in the Vision Science program, and I wanted to give you guys kind of an overview of the kind of research that I do and exactly how I use Python to do a lot of this research. So in order to understand exactly what I do, you kind of have to know the science behind it just a tiny bit. You don't necessarily have to actually pay too much attention to it, just to give you a gist of it. So my talk is actually going to be two different sections. This first one will actually be a full hands-on demo. You're welcome to follow along. The data files are on the schedule, and they're pretty small, and you can actually download just the neurons.hf5 file, and that'll let you follow along with the notebook correctly. The second section, I'm going to show you basically how you install additional packages, as well as a small package that I wrote to let you kind of see how a lot of these Python tools can be used in developing new tools for science. And we'll kind of get into that for the second half of the talk. So to begin with, my lab is in the business of trying to figure out how the brain sees things. So when you look at an image of the world, like this can of spam, your brain is doing something, and it's spitting out some sort of a signal that is encodes this image of a can of spam and somehow saves it somewhere or passes the information along to further processing streams. So in typically what you would do in a completely engineering framework, you would actually use something called system identification, where you basically try to build a black box where if you feed in the same image of the spam can, it'll actually output the exact same signal as the brain. This is, of course, in the ideal world where we have no noise and we know exactly what the brain is doing. Of course, this is not true at all, so we're not very good at doing this yet, but we know some properties about it that can help us get us closer. So basically, the fundamental unit of the brain is the neuron, and these are individual cells in your brain that can send or process information. And they kind of respond a little bit like little signal filters. So they take some sort of an incoming signal, they convolve it with some sort of a filter, and if it exceeds some threshold value, they'll send off an electrical impulse as a spike. And this spike actually confers information downstream for additional processing. But the problem is neurons are not that simple. They exist in this kind of big mesh network of other neurons that actually exist in this fluid that kind of smears the signal around, and you have all this other low frequency signal as well. So when you actually stick a little metal probe or a glass probe into the brain, the signal that you record looks like this, a little bit like this. This is, of course, simulated data, but it gives you an idea of what it would look like. You kind of get like this weird low frequency stuff. It's probably going to drift around quite a bit, and then you'll get these nice sharp spikes that are all over the place. And just to complicate the matter, you actually, since you're typically, unless you're doing some really single cell electrophysiology and actually directly putting the electrode where you want it, you're probably going to be picking up more than one cell on any given electrode. So now you have this really complicated process where you have a whole bunch of mixed in low frequency signals that you want to get rid of. So you're going to have to do some signal filtering to get rid of that stuff. You're going to have to do some sort of a clustering algorithm to actually figure out which cells are which based just on their waveforms. So there's a lot of pre-processing to go along with this. And we're going to actually step through this entire example that has all of these steps. So once you have the signal sorted out, where you have each channel of your matrix is now just when the spikes occur. You can basically run a really, really, really simple model that basically assumes that your cells are linearly related somehow to the input. So all you need to do is basically take your input stimuli, run it through some sort of a linear model, fit it to your responses, and check what they look like. So we're going to actually go over this right now. So first things first, let's go ahead and start PyLab as usual. And we're going to import a couple of packages here that are some you've seen, some you've heard of, and a couple you haven't seen yet. So NumPy, of course, you've seen. PyTables was mentioned briefly, but is basically one of the best ways of statically storing large amounts of scientific data. And it's nice and cross-compatible with MATLAB and a lot of other tools. So I highly recommend you guys check out PyTables, or at least the HDF5 format. There's the SciPy module, which Barian gave a nice introduction to. And we're going to just pick out the signal processing module from it this time. There's also this module called sklearn, which is actually a very nice big repository of machine learning algorithms that are already implemented for you in Python. So it's really nice and easy to get all of these analysis tools just up and running immediately. And matplotlib, actually, these MPL toolkits are actually part of matplotlib, and they implement some pretty nice looking 3D plotting for matplotlib. There are other packages for doing 3D plotting in Python. One of the biggest and more well-developed one is called Mayavi. Unfortunately, it's kind of a pain to install. But once you have it installed, it's really cool because it actually sends all of this information into your graphics card. And you'll be able to plot 10 million points pretty quickly, so in real time, and drag it around in, all in your GPU. So it works pretty well. So let's just go ahead and import all these things. So now we're just going to open up this neurons.hf5 file, which is the demo file that I sent out that actually contains just some simulated neural data along with the input data that I used to elicit these responses. So let's just open it up and take a look at the H5 object, see what it looks like. And we can plot what the raw responses look like. And so if we just do that, you can see that the neurons.hf5 object is actually a file object that has, so HDF5 formats actually have this group structure that kind of resembles folders, files within folders. So in this case, I actually includes two variables, one called raw, which is just the raw response data, and it's an 180,000 long array. And these are just time samples. And there's also stimulus, which is basically what I use to elicit these responses, the images, so to speak, that we showed to the neuron. And if we just plot a small 1,000 sample chunk of this, we see that we get what we expect. We have these nice sharp spikes from neurons themselves. We have this kind of low frequency up and down thing. And we also have just electrical noise, Gaussian distributed electrical noise. So let's continue. So first things first, we want to go through the signal and filter it. So remember, we want to get rid of that low frequency signal because that's a totally, that's a different signal. There is information in it, but we don't want to model that today. Let's just go ahead and use a third order Butterworth filter and run it through a non-phase shifting filtering algorithm here. So if anyone's familiar with signal filtering theory, this is very standard stuff, and all these tools are available in MATLAB as well. If we just plot this signal, once we filter it, we get kind of what we expect. If we kind of look around, we see this low frequency drifting noise, and now it's all cleaned up, right? It's nice and clean, and it's all only the low frequency stuff. But what we actually want to model are these high frequency spikes, right? So in order to do that, we have to just subtract them off. So if we take the raw data that we had before, we subtract off the low frequency stuff and plot it, now we have a high pass filter. And we can see we have that Gaussian noise from electrical noise, and we have the nice spikes. So now the next step is we have to sort these cells to figure out which spike belongs to which cell, in effect. We go through and basically we just threshold the data. So say whenever these signals exceed 5, we'll find out where they are in time, and we'll plot them. And you can see that they're just these little single spikes that occur at random intervals. But what we can do with that is basically for every single one of these spikes, we can look at when they occur by using just a kind of a nice little trick. We just take the binary vector, which is just 0001 whenever there's a spike. If we take the temporal differential of it, it'll give us basically whenever it's greater than 0, it'll give us when the leading edge of a spike occurs. And if we figure out when that is, this will just give us the list of time stamps when each spike has occurred. And what we can do is basically slice out a small block of the data around when each one of these time slices occur, and then just plot all the spikes that we see. And you can actually see that there's, you know, quite a bit of electrical noise, but you can clearly see there are at least 2, possibly 3 different cells in this kind of messy thing where you have like one hump that kind of comes up to here, another hump that comes up to here, and another one that goes up even higher. So these different cells are selective for different things, and they have different, when they fire, they look different to that electrode. What we can do now is basically plot this information in principal component space. So basically, we have about 30 samples of each cell. We can look at each spike as if they were one point in this 30-dimensional space, and we want to reduce that dimensionality down to just 3 dimensions. So we use the decomposition module from sklearn. We run PCA, and we only want the first 3 dimensions because that's easy to visualize. So we fit the PCA. The nice thing about sklearn is everything, their API is actually very, very standardized. So whenever you run any one of their algorithms, the way that you use them is very similar. So sklearn, when you create a PCA object, you get this thing back that is basically the model. And you want to fit your data, fit the model to the data. So you tell PCA.fit and the spike data. And then you can put the spikes into this 3-dimensional space and get the projections in this reduced dimensionality space. Spikes, forgot to run these. I keep forgetting to run all of these. There we go. Okay, so now we have the projections. What we can do is basically use matplotlib in its 3D modes to look at what the three projections, what the 3D projections look like. And you can see that in this case, we have at least clearly two different blobs and another third blob that's out here and something hanging off there. I don't know what that is. But the cool thing is, since we have such nice separation between the blobs, we know that there are three very distinct cells, and we can kind of do a very simple algorithm, a simple clustering algorithm called Gaussian mixture models to cluster them and assign labels to them. So we want all the cells that are in this blob to be of label 1, all the cells in this blob to be label 2. Doesn't really matter which label they are, just that they're separate. So again, we're going to use a tool from sklearn to get at this. It's called the mixture submodule, and we're going to use Gaussian mixture models. And based on the PCs, we can see that we have about three distinct cells. So we're going to tell we want three different Gaussian mixtures. And exact same syntax, we're going to take the we're going to create an object that represents the model of the Gaussian mixture model, and we're going to fit the projections to them. And then we can predict, use the model to predict what the projections should be and get the labels. So if we just run this, we can see that we get a series of label indices for whether the cell, the spike was cell 1 or cell 0 firing. And again, if you run this, depending on the starting conditions, you're actually going to get different labels for each. But that's what Gaussian mixture models are supposed to do. And we don't really necessarily have to care that they're giving us different labels, just that they're different cells. So now we basically we recreate the original signal now to create like this binary mask signal of when each cell spiked, kind of unwrapping it with this little code block. And we can see that this this green cell seems to spike quite a bit, but you still get a couple of spikes from the blue and the red ones. And they're just three separate cells. We don't know what they're doing. But now we've aligned them such that we have time samples from the stimulus as with aligned time samples on the response that are separate. And now we can run regression. So let's continue on. So we know before that the cells respond as a simple linear filter, we can actually use a very nice linear model module from scikit-learn again. And we're actually going to use something a little fancier. If you run ordinary least squares regression on these cells, because they're thresholded binary impulses, they're going to be really, really, really noisy because there's no way to send like a graded signal. So because they're spiky signals, we're actually going to use regularized regression in this case. And I've pre-picked some alpha values that work pretty well for you. But you know, this is typically a really complicated algorithm to be implementing yourself each time, but it just exists already in sklearn. So we can, again, it's the same syntax. We create a model object with these attributes that define what the model are. And we fit the stimulus and the response to it. And bam, it's done. Very simple, very quick and easy. And now we can just directly plot the model coefficients. These are the filters. These are the things that the cell cares about. And if you can see, the green cell seems to have a big impulse here. So this is like the things that they care about in the image. And the blue cell has this little hump right there. And the red one is another much smaller magnitude kind of up and down and up cell here. So in just a couple of simple steps, 20 lines right here, we've actually seen exactly an entire electrophysiology, pre-processing, and analysis pipeline. So just to give you kind of an idea of how powerful Python can be in this case. So that was about, this is just to give you a taste of what kind of code we actually use in research. And while this data was actually fake data, the next data set I'm going to show you is completely new and was actually collected on myself. So that's pretty cool. We'll get on to that. So again, this experiment is actually done with the exact same system identification framework. So in this case, instead of sticking little glass or metal electrodes into the brain, we're going to use a another method of imaging the brain called fMRI. So you take your standard MRI magnet, and when you collect a whole bunch of images, special images, every 2 seconds or so, you can actually look at the changes in blood flow, which are mostly correlated to what the brain is doing at any given time. And in this case, we're showing the person this incredibly psychedelic and incredibly boring stimulus of a flashing bar. And this is actually what we see inside the magnet, and you're just supposed to stare right at the center and stare at it and watch as it grows and kind of shrinks and, you know, moves around. And the thing is, this, we've coded this stimulus such that every 4 seconds it's going to change and kind of expand out by one bar, and we know that this is what happens to the stimulus. So this is called a frequency encoded stimulus. We can actually do a very simple analysis right after this to get a very good idea, to get a very good picture of what the brain is doing just in terms of vision here. So before we get on to that, MRI is a really complicated imaging modality. You need some really special domain-specific software to actually visualize it and analyze it because it's huge and very, very weird. So to go over basically the next step, which is, let's say you got this MRI data and you don't know what to do with it, but you went online and let's say you went to some website, you searched up MRI Python, and you find this nice little package called NiBabel or whatever, and you want to install it. So how do you get new packages in Python? Unfortunately, this is not always the simplest thing, but depending on how well the package was constructed, it could be very easy or it could be very hard. So in the simplest case is Python has this package manager called PyPI. So if we go to Python packaging index right here, you can basically search through this website for just about any package that you want. If it was a well put together package and people use it, it's probably on PyPI. And if it's here, the nice thing is it's probably packaged such that you can run a single command to basically get that onto your system. It's this one right here, sudo pip install cython. And if it's already installed, it'll tell you. It'll say you already have it. And since I know that I already have this package, I'm not going to install it. But always try to check PyPI first for any package that you want to use because it's already prepackaged for you and it's nice and easy to deal with. If, however, you just get some random package that was just posted on GitHub or on someone's personal website, but the person actually made some vague effort to make it easy to install, then usually it's also a pretty straightforward process. It kind of follows a very simple old pattern. You grab the package that it exists in, you extract it, you go into the directory, and then there'll almost always be a setup.py file, and you should be able to just type sudo python setup.py install. Now, depending on how involved this installation process is, you could start getting into compilers and stuff, but hopefully if it's a nice simple Python package, it'll just dump it in a directory and it'll work. So the last case is basically a worst case scenario, is the person wrote a Python module in their spare time, didn't bother to write any documentation, didn't bother to write any setup scripts. All he gave you was this file, this module that you have to import. And what do you do with it? So generally, when this occurs, the easiest thing that you can do is create this directory in your home directory called Python packages, and then set your environment variable Python path to match that. Any package, any Python module package or whatever that you drop into this directory now becomes exists in your Python path, and you should be able to import it from anywhere in Python. Now, the Python path is actually kind of complicated to get at, but if you want to take a look at what yours looks like, we can go into here, and it's under the sys module. Yeah. Okay. If you import the sys module, sys.path contains your full Python path. These are the list of imports. These are the list of places that Python will look for possible modules when you try to import them. And you can add to it, you can directly append to this list if you want it for just that one session. Or rather, you should probably put things into your Python path just to make sure that they're always accessible from somewhere. So that's just kind of the 5-minute overview into installing packages for Python. Depending on whether which operating system you're using, you're going to have varying levels of difficulty installing certain things. And it really depends on whether you have compilers available and whether the package itself requires anything separate. But generally, the help files for the package, as well as additional documentation from it, should tell you what's and the error messages from these tools will tell you what you need to actually install. So let's assume that I just installed this nice little package that I wrote called PyCortex. And this basically lets us visualize MRI data that's been aligned to the cortical manifold that we've segmented. So if you don't understand those words, it's fine. I'm going to show you some pretty pictures. So first things first, let's import our tools. So I saved out this raw data file that I collected from my brain a while ago. And it's in an MPZ file format, which is, I think we mentioned during the NumPy lecture, is a nice compressed file format for saving NumPy arrays. And if we look at it, these MPZ files, when you load them from MP, they look like dictionaries. And each dictionary and each item in your dictionary is basically a single array. So in this case, I have two arrays in this file. One is the raw data, and one is the mask that I use to mask the raw data with. So to continue on, if we take a look at just the raw data itself, we print it, we have this strange shape that is 270 by 70,000. So in this case, I know because I collected this data that we have 270 time samples and about 70,000 voxels in the MRI data that we're concerned with, that we think that there's brain there. So we can use a tool that was part of PyCortex to unmask it and show what one slice of this brain looks like. And if we just imshow this volume, we can see that this kind of looks like a slice through the brain. So we know that our data is there now. We can also use another tool in PyCortex to actually visualize all the slices of the brain in this 2D mosaic. So just quick way, as always, you should always look at your data. Make sure that you look at the data, make sure that it's not scrambled in some way, and then you won't be in pain when later on you're analyzing it and it's all white noise and you're like, why? So always look at your data first. Now we're just going to do something simple, which is take a z-score. So we're going to subtract off the mean from the raw data and divide by the standard deviation so that they're standard deviation. And although we do say that typically we don't need to care about memory management in Python, in this case, since we're actually working with a reasonably large data set, we don't want to be polluting our namespace with large variables that are just going to sit around. So we have this del keyword in Python that we don't usually use, but in this case, it actually just marks a variable for deletion. It doesn't actively delete it, so it's not like a C++ destructor where it actually gets unallocated at this time. It actually just subtracts the reference count by one. So the way that the Python garbage collector works is that it's a reference counter. If the number of references that refer to a variable is zero and the garbage collector is being run, it'll delete and free that memory. But in this case, we're just decrementing that reference count by one and trying to make sure that that this variable goes away as soon as possible, because we don't need it. It's just a temporary variable in between. Yes?
Is there a way to actually run the garbage collector?
Yes. There's a GC module built into the standard Python modules, and it's just gc.collect. Run it as a function, collects garbage. So now we're going to show some fancy pictures. Hopefully it'll work. We're going to actually look at the raw time series data. So this is what the machine collects after you subtract off the mean and look at the standard deviation, basically. So this is, you know, this is the picture of a brain. In fact, this is my brain. this is the front of the brain right here, and this is the back of the brain. We have some areas marked out here. The visual cortex, the part that is responsive to vision, is right back here, kind of in the butt of the brain right here. And then these are the temporal lobes right down here. So they're kind of out by your temples, maybe a little further back. And what we can do is, since I've actually run a whole bunch of these experiments, we've actually carefully generated these surfaces to have nice properties such that we can actually kind of blow it up like a balloon a bit and see more into these cracks. Or we can actually completely flatten them. So we introduce some slices into this brain. So let's slice off just the middle of it, and you can see that actually there's holes here now. We can completely flatten this brain like this. And so just to remind you what this looks like, this is the back of the brain. This is the visual cortex. This is what's responsive for vision. So we know from many years of neurophysiology that when you show flashing lights to some animal, the visual cortex starts blinking on and off. And then here in this middle of the brain here is basically motor cortex. So if you stick an electrode, deliver an electric shock, they're going to do some crazy muscle movement. And then this is the frontal lobe of the brain, which does crazy personality, emotional things that we don't quite really understand. But we have imaging data from it because it's MRI and we collect the whole brain. And the cool thing about this package specifically is that it actually downloads all of the data at once and you can play it as a movie. Now, just as a reminder, that the stimuli that we're looking at inside the magnet here is that blinking kind of ring that's oscillating. So what we're trying to see is basically in this back portion of the brain, we should see kind of an imprint of this ring if the brain works as we think it does. And the ring, remember, kind of expands and contracts repeatedly in this Fourier encoded stimulus. And you can actually see there's something kind of moving from the middle right here and moving outwards. So this property is called retinotopy. We know that this exists in early visual cortex, so that certain areas of your visual field map directly to certain areas of your brain. So now that we're actually seeing the real data that we're using to model, we know that there's something there that we can model. So this is, again, goes along with the idea of always looking at your data. If you can look at your data and something's happening, then you should be able to model it. So let's get out of that. So this is a really simple analysis script for this kind of data. Since we did that Fourier encoding, we can just take an FFT of the data and then look at the phase lag. We're basically, since it's always going to be cyclically repeating, we know that at a certain phase lag, part of the brain's going to be active. And we're just going to see where the phase is across the entire brain. And that'll give us an idea, since each part of the circle, since it's contracting this encoded method, each part of this, each slice of the visual field will be active in only a certain part of the phase. So this way we can actually map when a part of the brain is active based only on the Fourier phase. So we compute that. It takes a little while, but it runs pretty quickly. And now we can actually show what that map looks like. So now we're going to look at what each part of the brain is doing, when each part of the brain is actually responsive to this weird blinking stimulus. And you can actually see right in the center of the brain, we actually have the middle of the brain right here. We have the same color, which means that they were active at about the same time. We also have like this expanding structure. So this is basically doing exactly what we're expecting it to do. And it all terminates right along these lines here too, which is actually these lines were drawn from this data. These lines are hand annotations saying that this is about where we could stimulate with our screen. So we're actually looking at real MRI data and the analysis that we're using to show some of it. So this PyCortex package is something that I wrote, and I'm hoping to get it up on GitHub as soon as possible for any of the MRI researchers who are interested in using it. So pretty nice and easy to contribute to the Python community. All right. I think that is all I have. Yep. Thanks. And just to give you some kind of resources, always look for SciPy information. SKLearn is a great resource. So go find scikit-learn, just type it into Google, you'll find it. Gives you a whole host of, and an expanding host of nice machine learning techniques. And scipy.statsmodels is also great. So just give these packages a Google and you'll find them. All right, thank you.
We have a question.
Oh, question?
Can you talk for a second about kind of your development environment? Are you using just a text editor to mess with your Python files or something more sophisticated?
Yeah, I'm just using Sublime Text to write most of my code. It's nice and convenient, and you don't have to learn any obscure key combinations like Vim or Emacs. So there's that. But nothing fancy, just using a text editor.
Okay, the combination of that and then the command line Python.
Yeah, yeah. A lot of this was developed before the IPython debug mode in the web notebook was available, so it was mostly developed using the command line. Yep. All right. Thank you.
All right, go ahead and take a quick break. Yeah.
No, just go. Okay. Well, while I set up, it's going to take me a minute. But I'm going to go.
Let's make sure that this thing all comes together.
Right.
Make sure. You have just a regular VGA, or do you
VGA need... would be preferable.
Okay.
Preferable.
It's right there. Yes.
And I have some scripts that will make it happy. Let me see. Projector. How's that?
Let's take a look.
You've got great. Okay, good. So if I go, okay, so that's what I want. Let me see. There, 6, 7. And if I go, 7. All right. He just walked out. Just walked outside. Say it again.
What are you gonna talk about?
Gonna talk about. So here it is. Fetching data. Here, let me. How's that? Is that better? Scraping data, simple database stuff, and then sending out emails, and then do a simple web server. And I don't know how much of this I'm gonna get through in that hour, but.
What's up?
Oh, Fernando was looking for you.
Oh, everything okay?
I think so, yeah. Oh, you guys can't see that at all.
Is there any chance you can make your background white? Can you change the color on it?
Yeah. Does this work? How's that?
Yeah, that'll be great. And then what you'll probably want to do is you'll want to move the scripts up. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
So that way they're more like, because as you get down to the bottom, the people up top have a hard time seeing. So you might want to like zoom in exactly. You want to zoom in and get it all nice.
Okay.
Yeah. Let me turn off these lights so that we can get
a good
view.
Okay. You all set?
Yeah, I think so.
Network stays there and up.
Yeah, right.
If it dies, then maybe try to get back on the other web. Or
okay.
But hopefully it won't die.
Okay. Okay, cool. Okay, hey guys. So I'm going to get started. So I'm Paul. I was in the vision science program. They sort of told me to come back when I finished my dissertation after 7 years, which was just a month ago. So go 7 years in grad school. Yeah.
But I have been working on IPython and on Matplotlib, so I'm really happy to see more people using these tools that I've sank a lot of my graduate career into. So that's good. Today, I'll be talking about a lot of different things, and I don't know how many of them I'll get through during the hour. And what's going to be the way that I'm going to do it is we're going to sort of try to code along for some of the things that come in the standard library, and there are batteries included that you won't have to install anything. And then towards the end, I'm just going to sort of show you some cool stuff that you can do with some extra packages that you might want to know about as far as making web servers and things like that. So the brief overview, and I'm going to get my timer going, 3 o'clock, is that we'll learn how to fetch things from the web. Then we'll do a little bit of data scraping. So this will be, we're just going to go out to Twitter and get some stuff and grab some usernames, people talking about PyBoot. And we'll do that in two different ways. So we'll do that using batteries included, just using string methods. I'm not going to go over regular expressions because that would be another sort of 2 hours. That, but you guys should know about it if you're going to be doing anything with text data, for sure. It is built in as well into the Python standard library. And then finally, I'll show you a solution using a library called Beautiful Soup that you would have to install in a manner that James just showed you in the previous talk. But you'll see that it's a lot simpler to do it that way. And then we're gonna take a brief break, a brief detour. I'm a cyclist, I love to go cycling. And sometimes I like to invite my friends. So we're gonna make a little database of my friends and any cyclists in the audience? All right, so I'm gonna ask you, because I saw your, for an email address later on. So prepare an email address for me. And then we're gonna try to send out an email to, so we're gonna put my new friend, Ryan, in the database, and then we're gonna try to send Ryan an email inviting him to go cycling. Okay, so, and this is all gonna be in Python, so that's gonna be great. I won't talk about SQL Alchemy, but that's one of the sort of database interfacing libraries that's out there that's actually sort of database agnostic, that you sort of write the same code to access SQLite database that you might have locally on your machine, or some big Postgres or MySQL database living elsewhere. And so if you want to know how to interact with databases, SQL Alchemy is sort of might be your first stop there. But there are other tools as well. So then I mentioned the sending out emails. And oh, and by the way, this is all in that Git repo that that we've been working in. Do they have that clone now, or not necessarily?
No.
Okay. So they should not clone it because it's too big. Okay. Do not clone. Forget it. Maybe if somebody could add direct, one of the counselors could add direct links just to these files. That'd be great. Okay, and then finally. Time permitting, I'll go through, well, first, an example of how you can just start up, again, batteries included, how you can just start up a HTTP web server to just serve some content that you might have in a directory. And it turns out it's just that one line. And then we'll go through and use a third-party library called Flask that's it's called like a micro framework, and we'll see how easy it is to write Python code that then can interact with it can be sort of like a little mini Twitter clone or something like that. We're going to try to do something with Twitter. It's not quite finished, but we'll see how one might go about doing that. And I'm fully preemptive and interruptible, so if you have any questions at any point, please just raise your hands, or just or let somebody know on HipChat, and then somebody in this room can do that. So let's dive into URL lib. Okay, so. URL lib 2 is a module that we're, and so this is the type along portion. This is the stuff that you will all have. So go ahead and import URL lib 2. And what we're going to do is let's say that you want to get something, you want to fetch something that's out there on the network. And so let's just get a handle on that. Maybe that'll be, we'll just call it some object that we get back, will be URL lib 2, URL open. And then you just give it a regular URL. So you can say http:// duckduckgo.com. There's another search engine you might have heard of, but oh, and I shouldn't use object. Why did object light up? Does anybody know? That's a built into Python, right? So I shouldn't really call it object. Let me just call it obj, the thing that we get back. Okay? And so what are the things that obj can do now? Well, it turns out it has methods. These look like sort of like file methods. You can close it. I wonder if there's just like a read. Oh, look, there is a read. Okay. So what if I just do read? There you go. It turns out that if you go to duckduckgo.com and you view the source on that page, you will get this thing back. Right? Okay. So we just went out to the web and grabbed something. Anybody impressed? I'm impressed. I mean, so that's pretty cool, right? And so the one thing that we want to make sure to remember when we do this is that you have to do an obj.close at the end. Otherwise, you're sort of leaving things floating around out and about, and that's not so nice. Okay, so let me get out of this, and let's say that we want to go to Twitter, and we want to search for PyBoot, or how about the hashtag PyBoot? Okay, and so up here we got this long URL thing. Let me just grab that and see what we can do. So PyBoot URL is gonna be equal to that thing. Okay. Oops, sorry. All right, so what are we gonna do? Let's do the same obj trick. Okay, so obj url lib2 url open pyboot url, and just grab the content from there is gonna be obj.read, and then we're gonna do an obj.close. Okay. So this is if I just let me just print the beginnings of content. So let me do the first maybe 512 characters. So this is what that looks like. Twitter search PyBoot latest from. Okay, let me do first 2,000 characters. Okay, and maybe one thing that we want to do is let's try to get the usernames of people using the PyBoot hashtag, right? So we've grabbed the data, and now let's do something with it. Let's extract some minimal subset of information that we're interested in from this data set.
Sorry, can you scroll up for just a moment?
Yeah. Let me try to make, if I make the font smaller, is that better for you guys? Are you still able to see?
Maybe get rid of your bookmark bar
should be gone. Oh God, how do I do that? F11, yeah, that's what I had before. Is the font okay like this? Head nods? No? Bigger or smaller?
Bigger.
Bigger font.
Yeah.
Good?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, so I, let's see, if I do this, 3, 4, one, two. Okay. So if I view the source here when it works, I'm going to try to. There are these. Whenever there's a username, it turns out that it uses this little. So I looked at the. This isn't something you figure out in an instant. This is something you sort of look at the source code and then try to figure out how to get at your data. And we're just going to try to get at it using just string manipulation. So we're going to, I noticed that, I kind of want these usernames out. And I see that right before a username, there's always this little less than S, greater than S symbol with an at sign. Okay. So there's one. Here's another one, right? And then the thing immediately after that is in bold, it has the username, right? So here's another one. So it's Fernando being mentioned in this case. And okay? So let's just try to find that in our content, okay? So content, find. And I'm just going to give it, just so we know what we're doing, let's just call it an sort of an at symbol placeholder that is that thing. At. Okay. So, and just so we remember, find, we want to say, we want to find some substring. So in this case, we want to find the at symbol substring. Turns out find also takes a start parameter, which will become useful, but let's just try to find the first one. So find at symbol. So at character 6,223, it found this thing. Okay, so let's take a look. Let's just poke around there. So
it's way too fast.
Okay.
I can't see what you did before.
Oh, all we did is we just grabbed the content. So how many, raise your hands if you got the content. Okay, so four people. All right, well, let's go back. I mean, we got to do this. We're trying to search, get. Okay, who has network access? Let's. Okay, the same four people. Okay, good. All right, well, let's back it up. We can do this. We got plenty of time.
It's just hard because this notebook isn't on the schedule. Yeah, we can't
find the notebook. So I'll show you. So.
Just refresh the page.
Okay, thank you. Chris is saying.
Don't refresh anything. Just make a duplicate tab and then try refreshing that. Because otherwise, you might lose. Right?
You're talking to me or?
Yeah, you, but everyone.
No, you can just hit save. Why can't you hit save?
Never mind. I'll explain.
Oh, you mean because the network's out?
Yes.
Oh, I see. Is the network out for everyone? I mean, this is. Okay, so so the notebook is schedule. I'm getting a text message. Oh. So can someone ask Paul to repeat, Fernando? I'm getting your text messages. We're just talking to the comment was that nobody is. I'm going too fast, and nobody is actually. There's only four people in the room that had downloaded things, and now the question was, where is the actual notebook that I'm dealing with? And actually, so I told you that there is a notebook link that you'll get it, but I'm just coding it live. There isn't, in the notebook, I show you where the complete answer is in the file, but everything that, all the code that's in this notebook is stuff that we just wrote together. Or should have been writing together, I should say. Stuff that I wrote that you may or may not have written. Okay, so how about this? Let's do it a slightly different way. Who's coming with me? Sort of a Jerry Maguire moment. Who's coming with me? All right. So out of those that are coming with me, who's imported URL lib? Good, or URL lib too, I should say. Okay, who's been able to open a URL and get the contents? All right, so that's a little fewer. So the way that we do that again is we call a URL open, and the thing that it returns, we just call the read method on it, okay? And the thing that gets read out, we're gonna put into a content, here I say content variable, right? Okay? And then we just close, just to clean up, we just close that little guy that we got. Okay. So, and I should say that the thing that content is, that the type of content is that it's a string, okay? So the rest of the ways that we're gonna be dealing with it, with all of this is just with string methods. That's the way we're gonna scrape, okay? So now who has content? Can I scroll up with a comment? Oh, this is just the content. This, I just showed this as an example. First, the one that we're actually going to want is you're going to want to grab the Twitter URL, which you can get by just going to Twitter and searching for hashtag PyBoot. It's probably the easier. Dan, can you fetch me a water? We should sign up for what? Twitter? You don't need to. No, that's the beauty of this, right? You won't need to, but okay, so I'm gonna get rid of this big content thing because we were just looking at stuff there. Okay. So the next thing that we're gonna do after we've grabbed the content is I did some legwork up front for you. I figured out that the way that we're gonna be able to find Twitter handles is by finding this little magic string. And immediately after it will be our Twitter handle that we want to get. And as a reminder, that that index will be 6223. It should be 6223 for you as well, I think. Or I guess maybe unless Twitter dishes out different content depending on, thank you, Dan, depending on your browser and things like that. Jared looks skeptical. Okay, so we got, who's got the at symbol thing typed in? Good, okay. It's about 10 of you, good. All right, so, and did you get the index? Yeah, thumbs up if you got the index? All right. That's true, yeah, if you're, we can moo. Next time we're gonna moo. No, we're gonna moo. There's no questions about it. All right, So indexing, so this is the sort of the weird thing when you scrape, not everything is as nice and tidy as you want it to be. The first thing that we come across isn't actually gonna be a Twitter username. It's an opening bold and then a closing bold. By the way, if you haven't seen HTML before, maybe I should have started off with that. HTML, sort of everything has an most things have an opening and a closing tag. Tags are things in between the less than or greater than signs. So, and the way that you close a tag is that it's a less than sign followed by a slash, kind of like we have so this is an opening bold tag, and immediately after it is a closing bold tag. And the way that it closes is it's a less than and then it's a slash, okay? Good? So let's go find the next index of the at symbol of the same thing. So basically, we're sort of, We said, find me an at symbol, and we chugged along, and I'm not going to be recorded if I go over there, but we chugged along, and we got to here, and oh, the little at symbol thing that you were looking for, that set of characters is right here. I'm like, okay, well, I looked at that. That's not what I want. Go to the next one. So basically, search again for the same string, but starting at 1 plus the position that you previously found. So you're not going to find the thing again, the thing that you just found. You're going to find the next instance of it. So go further along the train of the string and find that. Okay? So let's figure out what the next index is. So it's much further down, it's 24,393. And now let's take a look at what that is. So if you got empty content, chances are you didn't do index plus 20. You probably just did 20. You did something else. Okay. So now index to index plus 20. Cross our fingers. Okay, good. Right. So we're getting to be in good shape. Okay. So the way that and by the way, this is exactly sort of how I develop as I went along. So the solution already has a little function that does all of this. Altogether, but the way that I got that little function, the way that I wrote it is just by doing it by hand, interactively, and then sort of going, oh, okay, so I'm getting somewhere now. Okay, so basically the content that we're gonna want. So who's got the next iteration? I should pause and yeah. Good? Moo, we're mooing. Moo? Okay. There's no moos from this side of the room. Moo, okay. A very emphatic moo. Okay. You're working on a different link. How do I get here? I searched for hashtag PyBoot. Yeah. On the Twitter. Okay. So, okay. So the way that we're gonna get to meow, okay, is one way to get to it. So index gets us to the beginning of the little marker that we wanted to, right? So we're gonna at least need to do sort of plus length of our at symbol, right? So if we do just that, if we extract that part of the content, getting closer, right? Does everyone see what I, who doesn't see what I did there? About that. Does not see what I did? Yeah, so what's your, do you have a question about it or you just didn't see? Oh, you're not there yet. I see, okay, got it, sorry. Okay. Okay, yeah, so what I did was, let me make a new cell right above. So this used to say content index. So I'm gonna slice from the new index that I found to index plus 20. And my comment was is that, well, if I want the actual Twitter username, I'm not gonna need this part of it, right? The little, what I've called the at symbol signature. I'm not gonna need that. So at the very least, to the index, I'm gonna need to add the length of the at symbol, right? And actually, since there's a B immediately after it, I'm gonna add three more characters to that, right? Yeah? So if I add three more characters to that, so the length of the at symbol plus 3, and I go to the next 20, okay, that's looking promising, but I didn't get to the end of it, right? And so let me expand in this cell and say maybe ustart is gonna be the start of the username. I'm just gonna copy paste what I had here as the beginning of the slice. And so this is gonna be the new u start. Okay. And u end, the way that I can find the end is now if I go content find, and I instead of searching for the at symbol, I search for the closing bold symbol, and I start at where I was starting from before. Hopefully, I'll get the full. Is this person in the audience? No, okay. I just wanna make sure that I'm not sort of off by one or anything like that. If I take any bigger slice of that, then I start getting that B symbol. So I know I got the complete username, right? Can I get a meow if you've gotten this far? Heard one.
I'm learning to touch type right now.
Say it again?
I'm learning to touch type right now.
You're learning to touch type right now. Now's as good a time as any. But we only have 35 minutes.
Wants to see the list of commands, I put them on HipChat.
Okay, so the comment was is that to anyone who wants to see the list of commands, they've been put on HipChat. Thank you. Okay, so I'm gonna move forward then. So basically, so we've just gotten one of these usernames that we've extracted, and in the interest of time and sanity, and so that we get through more of this material, now I'm just gonna load in the solution and then sort of talk you through it, which is called Simple Scraper. Okay, so you don't need to worry about importing numpy as npt. So here's that same URL. I just read it, grabbed the content. Okay, and here's, I call this function, scrape usernames quick and dirty, and all it takes as an argument is the content. I add a little doc string saying that it extracts all the at usernames from content of a Twitter search page, okay? Now, when I wrote this, I was a little bit smarter, or at least I got around the weirdness that we added here with len symbol and plus three by just making my at marker the full thing, okay? And then I also just made a little end marker just so for clarity again. And then I started off with an empty list of usernames with a start equal at zero, right? I find the first hit. I call, instead of an index, I called it a hit, okay? And so the first time I'm starting at zero. Now, of course, if I didn't find anything, find is gonna return minus one. That's the way that it lets you know that there's nothing, the thing that you were searching for is not here, okay? And we're gonna need that so that we stop eventually, right? Because at some point, we're gonna get to the end of the page and there won't be any more at things there. Right, and so find at some point won't be able to return us anything, and so we want to make sure that we whenever that point is reached that we stop, and so that's what the break does. So break will break us out of this true loop, right? But if that's not the case, then we do have a hit, okay? And so then we're going to step over the little marker that we got, right, and grab start immediately after that where the username actually is, okay, and similarly, we're going to find the next end marker from that new starting point, okay? And so, and as a reminder, the end marker is the closing bold, okay? And remember that first one that we saw, the opening B and the closing B were right next to each other? And so it would actually be the case that the beginning and the end, the hit and the end, would be identical. So if they are identical, we're just gonna skip over that. We're not gonna do anything. And so only if they're not identical are we gonna slice into the content and just grab the username and add it to our, what was initially an empty list of usernames. Okay? So let's try running that. So I just executed just this function, which you have in simplescraper.py, and it was called scrape usernames quick and dirty. Scrape usernames quick and dirty, and I'm just gonna feed it the content, which I've already grabbed. Well, there you go. This is a list of people that were mentioned on Twitter. And so we returned it as a list, and you'll see some of them get repeated. Now, if we wanted to, we could sort of build a little index and do a little histogram of how many people are being mentioned more than others. Or we could just take the, if you want just the unique set of people, how would we do that? Does anyone know the simplest built-in? There's a set. Like there's a list, there's also a set, like a mathematical set. So if I just put this thing into the set, there you go. And so sets aren't sorted, but so the total length of that previous output is, so there's 23 unique people or organizations mentioned on Twitter. Okay, good. All right, so we're going to move forward. Josh, are you happy? Reasonably?
In general.
In general, good.
You mean right now?
Right now.
Less, but yeah.
Less happy, okay. Did you moo or meow?
No.
No. Okay, I'm gonna leave you alone then. The comment was that Josh is working on his next talk. Okay, so we did that, and so here's a simpler way of doing it. So we did that with the batteries included, sort of like, we're just gonna go, and the nice thing about that method is that sort of works on regardless of what the data is. It doesn't really have to be very structured, right? It has to be structured in some way that you can programmatically access it, but it didn't have to be HTML that we were fetching, right? These could have been CSV files that we were parsing through and things like that we're just grabbing off the web or something like that, or JSON files, things like that. Now, Beautiful Soup is a library that allows you to, when you are dealing with HTML, access things in a much more natural manner. Instead of having to keep track of the indices, you're sort of going to be able to declare, say, find me all of these types of tags, and then relative to those, something else, go to the next sibling, maybe go to the next tag over, and then grab the content of it. And that's what scrape usernames beautiful does. That was in scrape usernames beautiful. So the question was, where do we get that? Is there a file for that? And the answer is scrape usernames beautiful is in that same simple scraper .py file that I gave you. It's the second function in that file. Okay. So you will need Beautiful Soup for this to run, which you can try pip installing that or easy installing that. But if you don't, and I think Anaconda might actually ship with it. But this top portion is just the import statement, just giving a beautiful, giving an import error message for those of you that don't have it. What Beautiful Soup does is it creates a little soup object just from the content. So all we pass it is the content, which is that long string of all the stuff that we did. And it parses out a tree so that you can actually and keeps track of what the different types of tags are. And then you can just say, you can do this little one-liner to find all the things that are within a B tag. So following an S tag. So this is a list comprehension. This isn't a type along. This is just sort of a look at this sort of thing. So we're going to do, so it's a list comprehension. We're going to find all S tags that have inside of them an at symbol. So that was, that gets us sort of all the results that have the little S at thing, right, with the marker. That's what we call the at marker. And then for each one of those, we're going to find its parent. So we're going to be down here. So there's sort of a parent. It's a little tree that you make. That you can think of it as like a family tree, right? So each thing down below has a parent, sort of a tag that it lives inside of. We're going to go to the parent. We're going to go to the next sibling. So the parent of this at symbol is going to be that S. And its sibling, the guy that living next to it or the girl living next to it is going to be that B, right? It was an S and then a B right next to it. So find the next sibling B, right? And we're going to return that. So this is going to be all the Bs just in one line, right? We didn't have to do any indexing. We didn't have to do anything. Beautiful Soup just sort of does all that munging for us. And then same thing as before, we start off with an empty usernames list. And then for all the Bs, we look at the contents of it. So the contents is the thing actually holding the thing within the tag, okay? We make sure that the content length is greater than 0, again, because there are some tags that are open B, closed B right next to each other, right? So we're gonna skip over those. But for the ones that actually have some content in them, we're just gonna append that, the contents as into our username list. Okay, and I'm gonna split the cell here and make a new one and say scrape usernames executed so that we have it loaded. Say scrape usernames beautiful content and show you that if we take the set of this, it'll be the same as before. The little u prefix is just that it's Unicode. Don't worry about that. But I can tell you that the length of this is the same as before, 23. Okay. And actually, what I've done here is the next thing is a little test function that verifies when you grab some URL, so it grabs the content one time, and then it tries to scrape it our two different ways. And then I try to verify using, here it's using NPT, which you would have to, that's the import numpy.testing as NPT. That's all that's necessary for that. And it will assert that all of those things are identical. They're the same. Because they'll come back, the list will come back in the same order, and those all of those things should match. Okay? So 25 minutes. Okay, so that was scraping data using string methods, with batteries included, and using Beautiful Soup. Another way of doing it, like I said, is regular expressions, but you can click on that link and sort of follow up on that if you either know what regular expressions are or somebody tells you about it later on down the line. Okay, simple database operations. So this is where we're going to go biking, right? Go cycling. Let me see. So I'm just going to load up the file so that I work with it here. And I'm just going to split off chunks of it. So there's a few import statements here. And I have a logger just for myself. That's not interesting. Executed that. Okay. So I'm going to create so SQLite 3 is something that just comes with pretty much every standard Python installation. So this is something that you can import. You don't have to type along just so we get through the content here. But what it does is it creates a little database inside of a file, and then you can put things. And so what's a database? It's sort of like you can think of it as an Excel spreadsheet that you can do fancier things with. You can do some filtering with it and grab rows or columns out of it independently. And so that's what SQLite does. And so here I'm gonna create a new database file and create a table called cyclists that's going to have four fields to it. There's going to be a first name, last name, an email, and a status for that cyclist. And I'm going to populate it with, I have a little template here for how you, so this is something called SQL. There are different flavors of SQL or SQL, which is a database language for inserting, deleting, and selecting out and joining sort of different databases and different database tables. And so SQLite just has a particular flavor of it. And that's all we're doing here is that, so this C, this cursor, allows us to execute things in that other language. It's not Python, it's SQLite, okay? Create that table, and here's a template of how do you insert values into that table. And we're doing it from Python, so we don't have to retype these statements all the time. We're just going to leave four sort of placeholders for our strings that we're going to put in there. So remember, this is first name, last name, email address, and then the sort of the status or the type of cyclist it is. And so Ryan, what's your last initial, Ryan? Oops. So Ryan N, doing it live. Anything can happen. All right, and which email address are you okay with?
Just Ryan N-E-L-L-Y.
N-E-E-L-Y.
N-E-E-L-Y.
11. @gmail.com? Okay, and do you consider yourself a committed, like a crazy cyclist, a casual cyclist, or a weekender cyclist?
A weekender.
You're going to be a weekender, okay. And so, close that, and close that. And I missed some closing. There you go. Okay, and so then all I'm going to do is, this started off as an empty list, and then I added single list, list of size one to that list, so that it's just a shorthand for appending. I could have written append and then parentheses, but this is another way of doing it. I'm going to execute that query, so I'm going to insert those cyclists and put them in there. Okay. Whoa, that's not jumped around. Okay. So first, I'm going to make sure that I delete the old database that used to live there. So you won't need to do that because you never had one. I execute that, remember this was just a function, so nothing actually got called yet. So all I have to, what I have to do is I create friends table explicitly. And the feedback that I see is that, oh, it inserted my friends and my new friend Ryan into this database, okay? So how do we get things out of the database? Well, we're gonna make another function for that, okay? And this is that a select statement that, so when we select, we don't have to select all parts of the entry, we can just select some subset of it. So in particular, we're gonna select only the first name, last name, and the email, but we're gonna be more specific about who we select. We're not gonna just grab all the people, where the status of that cyclist has to be the kind that we want, right? And by default, the kind that we want will be committed cyclists, so Ryan will be excluded. Okay, so execute that, and let's just see what that does. So Dan Coates. So by the way, the email address, just because we will be emailing people, I just made it my email address for now, just so Dan doesn't, well, with Ryan, we'll see if it actually works. But okay, so receive a random cyclist. Oh, here I am. Here's Dan again. And by the way, I did order by random here, and that's just something SQLite provides for you. So it's just sort of a way of me not, when I go out cycling with just one friend, it's just sort of uniformly samples my friends, including myself again. I suppose I'm my own friend sometimes. Sometimes. And you'll notice that we're not seeing Ryan on here. And why aren't we seeing Ryan? He's what? He's a weekender. That's right. So how do we specify a weekender? Well, we have to say kind equals weekender. And now we see my buddy John, who works in San Francisco, so he can never go out except for the weekends. And there's Ryan. So, and there's Janet. And John again, and Janet again. Janet again, and John again. Okay. So we've created a little database of people. And so as new people come along, I'll be able to use the same code, and I'll just add, you know, I should have maybe made a method that does this add operation not all in one go, but just keeps updating it, right? So it keeps inserting into that table. Once I have those cyclists in the database, though, and now I have a way of retrieving a random single cyclist, even based on their type, okay? Now I can actually email them. And we're gonna, it turns out even sending out emails or parsing emails is built into the standard library. And that was, we're gonna use for that, I'm just gonna scroll up just to show you what the import statement is. This SMTP lib is the place to go for. And in the notebook that you guys got, where I only had the outline before we started filling it all out, there's a link to the SMTP lib documentation on there. Okay, and I've already set it up so that, let me back up here. You'll see that my email is not explicitly written into this file. There's a file nothingtoseehere.py that is currently holding my email address and my password, just so that I don't show you guys that. And in that nothing.py file that I checked in, there are instructions if you have a Berkeley EDU address for how you generate a Google key token so that you can put it in there and use your own email address and start sending out emails yourself, okay? And you'll just put that in the password field. So we make a new message, and the from email address will be mine. The to will be most of the time mine, except for when we start sending emails to Ryan. And then it's just the message string is, hey, person's name, you know, let's go for a bike ride later on today, okay? I have 15 minutes. I have a little logging message saying that it's sending it out. Here's where I set the password, and it returns nothing. So we've just declared that, and it was called email cyclist. So you'll notice that email cyclist takes an address, first name, and last name, right? And those are all things that we got from our retrieve random cyclist method. Okay, and so then I just go ahead and call it here for, in one method, go cycling. I create the database if it's not already there. So this time it's not gonna be there. Then I retrieve a random cyclist, and then I email that cyclist. So let me go cycling as one method, and just let's just go cycling and see who's gonna get lucky. Okay, so I emailed Sarah, which is my own address, but I to prove to you, that there it is. Let's go for ride, Sarah. So that's just 346. That just arrived here, and there's a little, hey, Sarah, want to go for a bike ride? Okay, and then the way that we can email, so by default, if I do this again, we're not going to get to email Ryan because we got Sarah again, because he's not a weekender, and our retrieve random cyclist here isn't specifying a weekender type. So if I just type in weekender here as the next thing, redefine that method, kind equals weekender, and go cycling. That still goes to me. Come on, Ryan. Ryan, think of the animal sound, that animal vocalization that you're gonna make when you receive that email, okay? Oh, come on. Come on, random number gods. Be on my side. We're just gonna do this the rest of the time. I think. It's not funny. No, seriously, what's going on? Oh, it's going random. What's going on? There you go. All right, Ryan. Caca. For those in the other room and for the YouTube recording, Ryan just said caca. All right, so we just did sending out emails. All right, so in the last 15 minutes, 10 minutes, we're gonna do a little bit of Flask. And first, we're gonna just start off with a simple HTTP web server. So right now, you are, who has their terminal open? All right, you are in some directory that has some files, yes? Type this command, Python space minus M. So you're not in IPython, you're in the terminal, right? You're in a shell. Type in Python space minus M, simple HTTP server, okay? And I'll do that along with you here. Clear, and I'm gonna adjust my, okay, Python. So I'm in here, and I have a bunch of files here, and if I go Python minus M, simple HTTP server, HTTP server serving on 000 port 8000. 0.0.0.0.0 is a way of saying all interfaces. So if somebody knows your IP address, they can get the listing of your ports right now. So if I go to localhost 8000, there you go. Here are all of my files. Oh, I'm negative screen there. Here are all my files. And if I click on one of them, then it just shows up there, right? So this is the appetite thing we were looking at earlier. Okay, how cool is that? Okay, not very apparently. Very skeptical audience here. All right, so that's kind of cool. And so let's go with something even cooler, where we're gonna, if I go like this, all right. So I'm gonna go with all, so I've installed something called Flask, it's a package on this machine, and here is a simple, so simple HTTP server was very simple, but it can only sort of serve content, right? You can sort of make files available on there in that directory and serve them out. Flask allows me to do something fancier. It allows me to return stuff to the web browser based on the URL scheme and make decisions on it, and make a little web application, right? And so here's a very simple Hello World web application. If I have a shortcut for running it, so all I've done is import from Flask, import capital Flask, add this little, you might have already seen this, this is a decorator. If you don't know what a decorator is, who knows what a decorator is? who's seen a decorator during the talks here? Oh, we did it on the first day. Okay, good.
If they're taking the class, they'll see it tomorrow.
And if you're taking the class, you'll see it tomorrow. Decorators are awesome. It's a way of wrapping a function and returning another function that sort of does things around it. It's really cool. In this case, what this wrapping will do, what this particular decorator does, is it makes this hello method available so that whenever I go, once I start launching this, whenever I go to the URL, the root of the URL, just that leading slash, it'll actually return hello world. So let's start running it. So I'm running it on this URL, so port 5000. And there you go. All it does is say hello world. Now to verify that I'm not lying to you, is just save this, execute that, hello Python world, okay? So okay, you might not be very impressed, but it's gonna get cooler in a second. Because we haven't done much here, right? This is just, we've written one little function and we've decorated it with a Flask thing. All right, so let's go to the next one. So this is a little bit more sophisticated. Now suppose I wanna do something based on what's typed in a URL. So I'm gonna have some leading URL things like user, and then this is gonna be, this thing in that tag is gonna be a variable. And that variable is gonna get passed in as a parameter to my function. So they have to have the same name, but then in that function, I can actually use that variable. So I can say, maybe hello, user something, okay? And I've added another thing because I was originally planning to do a Twitter thing. We're not gonna get through that, but the beginnings of it are in the repo. So I'm just gonna start running this. So not much has changed. We've just defined a new couple of methods that now the URL scheme for which allows for sort of parameters, and we use those parameters. So I'm gonna, gonna run that. So we're still on port 5000. So hello world, that's as is. But if I go to user Josh, it's gonna say hello user Josh, okay? And if I go to user Paul, hello user Paul, okay? If I go anywhere else, if I go to like users, that's just gonna be file not found, okay? Or if I go to, the thing that that was being demonstrated here is that the second method actually allows you to make sure that, oh, this tweet thing, that has to be an integer, okay? So let's see how that works. If I go to tweet here, if I try to go ASDF something, doesn't know about it, but if I say tweet one, okay, tweet ID one, 13, that works fine, okay? Okay, 7 minutes, doing good. Okay, so the next step is, how about we add some, okay. So this I've added a URL for, so you're able to, from within Flask, generate URLs for other things based on their methods. And so here I have this username method, right? That's called show user profile. And based on that method, no matter where that method gets routed to, I can grab that URL using this scheme. And so inside of a tweet that I'm gonna sort of by hand hard code a tweet inside of one of my tweets, I'm gonna create a link to my my Twitter handle from within Flask, okay? So this is sort of demonstrating the URL underscore for method. So I'm gonna start running it. Okay. And if I go to tweet number whatever, now you'll see there's a link there. And if I click on that link, that takes me to that username, okay? And you guys can't see that, but there you go. Okay? So again, this entire thing right now is 30 lines of code. And some of it is not necessary. Some of it is like a debugging statement and whether or not to run on a public interface. Okay, so next one is, now I'm gonna do something funky and make it look a little bit nicer, is I'm gonna link up the IPython notebook style files, so the default static files path, and I'm gonna make a static directory for that. And when the values that I return from my methods, which are just strings. That's all I've been returning from strings, which then get forwarded to over the web server. I'm going to add this little header that includes that style sheet in right here in the tweet. Okay, so the show tweet now includes a header and then includes a new little set of links that I've compiled and I've styled them so it looks a little bit like the IPython notebook. Okay, so let's run that. So again, this is all linked from that, or will be linked from that repo. So if I go here and I reload, oh, that looks familiar. If I zoom out a little bit, so it's, we've grabbed the fonts and little boxes like we've been seeing, the input and output in IPython, and I just grabbed that. Got 4 minutes. And it turns out that Flask out of the box, so this is getting tedious, right? Now I'm sort of, I'm getting, inserting lots and lots of strings in here. And what Flask does is it allows you to use templates. So this is, render template is one of the methods that it has. It uses a library called Jinja2, which we also use. Oh, thank you. Which we also use in IPython, this Jinja2 library. And so, when we say render template, we specify a file name that has to live in the templates directory. And then we pass it parameters that are needed inside of that template. So let me show you what one of those templates looks like. So here's what the template looks like for a tweet. So it's just plain HTML, except with these extra little tags, these little two curly brackets, and then something inside of them. That's the variable name that we're going to get from when we render the template. Those are the things we pass to it. And so let's see what happens here when I execute that. So, and the tweet has some content, things like that. So we're still on port 5000. So this is some test 13. Okay, and that's, it all came out from this show tweet method, right? And, but we've now rendered a template. So something that is HTML, we didn't just compile together a whole bunch of strings. It's HTML that has a way of sort of generating parts of it when you render that template. That's all the time that I have for you right now. But included in here were also ways of starting to scrape Twitter and use a Twitter API. That was the sort of to come back. So we scraped first, then we took a break, went cycling, and now we're building a sort of a web server that interacts with, that may interact with Twitter or has something to do with tweets. And one sort of the best way of doing it is to, when you have libraries available, you use those. You don't try to hand code your own thing. And so there, Twitter does have, even though I've showed you multiple ways of scraping it yourself, there are, it has an official library that you can just import Twitter and then use, get content back instead of having to spend a lot of time munging. So that is all that I have for you.
Hey, Paul, before you unplug,
yes, before.
Can you open the browser with a notebook open for just a second?
Yes, sir.
One quick second.
Just any.
Wait.
So, can I switch? How do I switch to the other? So, okay. one error that a number of you.
Oh, yeah, sorry, control.
Okay. A number of you had a similar problem when you tried to run the little snippet of code that connected to the cluster. You got some bizarre error about JSON files missing. So I think I just went too fast over this part. What happens is you haven't started your cluster yet. So that little snippet of code is the part that connects to the cluster, but you have to start it. And so the start the cluster part happens here in the dashboard where you say, start. You click here, and it will detect how many cores your machine has, and it starts. You can also change that, and you can start 10 or 1 if you want a different number of engines. Once you have run the start, then you execute that snippet of code, and you typically have to wait a few seconds for everybody to kind of be up and running, and then that piece of code runs correctly. But that error you were getting was simply because there was no cluster running, so you were trying to run the connection, and there was nothing to connect to. And maybe we can improve the error message a little bit to kind of give a hint of what may be going on. But that was the problem, and I had to answer this to multiple people, so I wanted to clarify. Paul, can we just unplug, or? Oh, from behind here. Thank you.
Great. So this is largely just a wrap-up lecture. I hope we can actually finish this early.
But let me say thanks to Paul and James for their lectures this afternoon, because really the point of that is to show you just how powerful Python is in so many ways. Remember, the core thing we were trying to get accomplished here in these 3 days is to get you up and running with the language itself. And now really the fun begins. There's obviously a whole lot to do. We've really only just scratched the surface. But I wanted to make sure before we all started scrambling out of here that you had a chance, either you're here at the Brouwer Center or maybe you've even been watching on YouTube, to give us some feedback. This is our fourth incarnation of the boot camp. And we like to think, like Python itself, we maybe fix a couple bugs and introduce a few new ones, but it's continually improving, we hope. And that only happens when we get real feedback from you. Okay, so what's next? First of all, again, a thanks to the sponsors of this program, the NSF, the Vice Chancellor's Office for Research, and for GitHub. And really to all of you who have made this really worth doing. We wouldn't be here if it wasn't for you, and we didn't think that this was an important thing for all of you to learn. So we hope you got a whole lot out of this. We always do. I always learn something each time I do this. But now we want you to go forth and do great science or do great research in general. So I thought, you know, sort of like, you know, import anti-gravity, if you type that, or from the XKCD, we could sort of show you just in a few lines of code how you're going to do science now. And you can fork this on GitHub, by the way. So within a try accept statement, because this is volatile from prior experience, import insight and serendipity. My new idea, I have to generate ideas using all of that stuff. And if I can't get a new idea from all of that stuff in the back, I should just copy somebody else's. Probably you want to make a deep copy. So now I need to fund and build a team. Am I funded? No. And I got to keep looping until I'm funded. So I have to write a proposal. So I have to generate a proposal based on my new idea, then want to execute the submit method. I now need to wait for a while, typically 6 months or a year. And then I get the response back, is the proposal funded or not? If not, just keep on going. Those of you going into academia will find this funny right now, but in 20 years you won't. We didn't talk about multiprocessing. You'll hear about that in the course for those that take it. Just a way of getting access to all the different cores on your computer. And what you do is you basically build up a whole bunch of pools of workers. So I'll just spin up 5 grad students because I'm now funded. I'll spin up a couple of postdocs, a whole bunch of undergrads. That's sort of a loose approximation for the size of my group on average. And now we'll have to do the work. So we get these results. We do get data. So I need to use the proposal cache. I have to find a result. I have to write the paper. Then I just have to submit the paper to Science. And this will be, of course, accepted without revision. Then we need to reap the rewards. So here's an item for my CV. I win a Nobel Prize. And I'm going to thank my grad students. Sorry, postdocs and undergrads. That's how it works. Anyway, so that's a little bit facetious. By the way, you can make pull requests on this if you think there's a better way to do science. Please do that. We want to sort of leave you with a couple of different places, pointers really, into the real world of where you'll go as you start getting help. The documentation from Python is and python.org is incredibly rich and incredibly useful. It's searchable. That is a great starting point. So please, if you haven't already, go to docs.python.org. As somebody mentioned today, you can also go to the PyPI, the Python Package Index. And typically what you'll see there are a bunch of third-party packages. And you know, one of the things that you need to be careful with as you're installing stuff is you probably want, there's probably 12 different implementations of the thing that you need. So if there's, I don't know how many Twitter APIs there are for Python, but there's almost certainly more than a few. You typically will want to install and use the ones that are most active. and have the most number of active contributors to those programs. So, you know, this takes a little bit of a sort of black belt experience to come across a package you've never heard of and figure out whether this is worth doing. Typically, if you come across like a tar.gz file that has that package somewhere on the web, and the last time it was touched was in 2001, you probably don't want to do it. If the last time it was touched in 2011, you probably also don't want to use it. You want something that's being actively maintained. Very rarely is sort of code finished. And so if you know that somebody really cares deeply about making this work, that's usually a good sign. Ask questions of the internet. Stack Overflow is a great place to go. Typically, if you're just Googling your question, you will get thrown to Stack Overflow. There's a whole bunch of things in the context of Python that you'll be able to get access to. Reddit even has a Python subreddit, which is pretty impressive. I was very happy when one of my talks made it on Reddit. That was kind of cool. I'm going to get there. I was very, very proud when my daughter, who's 7, today was her first day in second grade, she started using the IPython notebook to do calculator work. And so I'll say hi to her, you know, 10 years from now when she'll be embarrassed because she'll look at YouTube. And the IPython subreddit as well is also up there. So there's a lot of rich community here. And I want you just to be aware that, you know, in leaving here today, you're not sort of just losing all of your support for doing Python. Quora is another great place. Quora itself is basically built on top of Python. And one of the really fun things you can do, you probably will only now just understand how cool some of these things are, is to type in Quora cool Python tricks. And you'll get a bunch of fun things that you can do. And hopefully one day you'll contribute yourself. Why don't you just go ahead and friend Guido Van Rossum, the creator of Python. You could befriend Fernando Perez, if you'd like, the creator of IPython. You should probably unfriend Bill Gates at this moment. We won't go into a whole Windows diatribe at this moment, but you can understand. And of course, we hope to see many of you at the Python Computing for Data Science course, which starts tomorrow at 1 p.m., where you'll be learning, among other things, order dictionaries and decorators and iterators and all that fun stuff. But what you saw this afternoon is really just sort of a taste of the kinds of things that we will wind up doing in that class. So, yes? Yeah, so Fernando's reminding me that there's a Pi for Science campus mailing list. If you Google that, you'll just find the appropriate place to go. If you haven't already, let's do one last interactive session. Fire up your interpreter. Type import this. And you get a little poem about the Zen of Python and Python's philosophy. So I thank you all for a great time. We really enjoyed it. And thank you all for sticking with us. I hope you've gotten a whole lot out of it. So thank you, everyone. Yeah, thank you. All right, that's it. You don't have to go home, but you can't stay here.